permutations and combinations. Permutations and combinations. This chapter is basically not completely new to most of you because even in class 10th or as early as class 9th, we were basically taught permutations and combinations. Of course, in permutation and combination, in class 9th and 10th, in your junior classes, you basically count by literally making a set out of it, right? But now in 11th and 12th, the scope will be much broader, where we'll be using certain principles to count. Okay, we'll be talking about all those in our session today. And this topic is especially useful for the people who are preparing for KVPY. Okay, some news was there that KVPY has been called off by the High Court orders. We are waiting to, get more information on this news. As and when we get it, we'll keep all of you updated with respect to the news. And another important thing about this chapter is two other chapters are directly linked to this particular concept. One is your probability, and probability is there for you in class 11th and 12th both. Okay. And one more chapter which is required for your competitive exam, that is your binomial theorem, even though it is not there for your CBSE curriculum. That chapter also is very closely linked to permutation combination. Not everything would be required, but yes, the basic idea of permutation combinations will be used there as well. Okay. So here, first of all, let's understand the literal meaning of these two words, right? What is the meaning of permutation? Have you started this chapter in school? Anybody who has started this chapter in school? Can I hear from you? What is the meaning of permutation? Permutations. Permutations means arrangements, right? Arrangements. What is the meaning of arrangements? Does it mean ordering? Does it mean selection? Or does it mean both? Arrangement is an English word, right? So what is the meaning of that? Only selection. Okay. Only ordering. Okay. Yes, exactly. Arrangement is basically a combined activity of selection and ordering both, right? So let us say there are five people, or let's say there are 14 people. Nowadays, ICC T20 World Cup is going on. Let's say out of 14 people, sir, don't talk about it. India lost to Pakistan, right? How many of you wasted that 3.5 hours watching that match? I'm not happy that India lost, but basically, you should not be spending so much time watching a match. Okay. Anyways, so let's say there is a 14, member squad, and you want to select 11 people and assign them some order of batting, right? That is what we call arranging 11 people taken from 14 people. Okay. So in arrangements, we do both the activities. Ayo, Setu. We do selection as well as ordering. Selection and ordering. अरे हार जीत तो चलता रहता है यार, सो नॉट डोंट वरी अबाउट विनिंग एंड लूजिंग दैट मच. ओके, आई थिंक इट्स द फर्स्ट टाइम पाकिस्तान वन अगेंस्ट इंडिया इन अ T20 वर्ल्ड कप, राइट? ओके, बट ऑन द अदर हैंड, व्हाट इज अ कॉम्बिनेशन? कॉम्बिनेशन इज जस्ट सेलेक्शन. ओके, इट इज जस्ट चूजिंग. नो ऑर्डरिंग इज डन इन केस ऑफ अ कॉम्बिनेशन. सो कॉम्बिनेशन इज जस्ट सेलेक्शन. ओके, so how many selections or how many choices can be made? For example, if I ask you to just pick up a team of 11 from 14, no batting order is to be assigned to them, then that is a combination. Okay, now many people ask me this question, sir, in permutations you have selection and ordering both, and in combination there's only selection. So why do we study permutation first? Why the chapter name is even permutation and combination? They should call it as combination and permutation, right? Because permutation is a two-phase event. We have selection and the other phase is ordering, right? But in combinations, we only do selections, right? So why don't we study just combinations and then permutations? See, it is because permutation is more close to our fundamental principle of counting. That is why permutation is studied before combination. Okay? So we'll be talking about fundamental principle of counting also in today's session. But before anything, I would like to talk about factorials, because factorial is something which is going to be a tool in your hands while you're solving or doing a lot of calculations. Okay, so it's good that we have some bit of exposure to factorials. I know you have all done factorials with me during the bridge course. What is the difference between these two? A lot of differences there, Setu. See, let me give you a simple example. Let's say I say A, B, C, okay, D. I ask you to select three alphabets from A, B, C, D and arrange them. Okay. So what could be your possibilities? So if I talk about arrangements, your possibilities for arrangements would be the following. You have A, B, C. Okay. You will have, see, now you are selecting. Okay. I think I have taken a lot of alphabets. Let me take three only. Okay. And let me say, I want to arrange arrangements of two alphabets or two letters from ABC, two letters from this ABC. Okay. So you can have AB, you can have BA, you can have AC, you can have CA, you can have BC, you can have CB. Okay. So there are six arrangements possible of two letters from ABC. But if I say combination of two letters from ABC, so if I have combinations of two letters from ABC, then you can have only the following combinations, A, B, A, C, B, C. Okay. You don't have to order the choices that you have made. You just have to select them. And the moment you select them, the combination is completed. Okay. So these are your combinations. So there are only three combinations here, but there are six arrangements of two letters taken from ABC. Because here AB and BA, since you have, you know, changed the position of A and B, that is taken as a different ordering. Combination wise, it is the same combination, but the ordering of A and B here has mattered. That's why I told you, let's say if you're selecting a team of 11 people, okay, just selection is combination. But now if you decide who's going to bat at number one, at number two, maybe who's going to open, who's going to come one down, two down, three down, that is basically your ordering part of it. And that comes under arrangement. Subset, I can't say that, but yes, it's an activity which may precede. Okay. You'll come to know when I talk about both of these topics in detail. So normally it's not that you always select, but yes, there is a choice involved if you want to. Okay. We will talk about it. Don't worry about the nitty-gritties of these two topics. These topics will come a little later on. Before that, we have a lot of prerequisites to talk about. And the first of them being factorials. Okay. So what is the meaning of a factorial? Factorial is nothing but it is a continued product starting from the number n till you reach a one. Okay. Factorial is always found for a whole number, including zero, right? It is not defined for negative integers. It is not defined for fractions. Okay. In older books, you can see that this representation was used for factorial. Especially if you look at higher algebra, older books like Bernard Child, Hall and Knight, they use this kind of a representation to represent factorial. Some examples of factorial I'll give you over here. So let's say if I talk about 5 factorial. So we know it's a continued product from 5 all the way till you reach 1. Okay. 5 factorial is nothing but 120. Okay. 4 factorial. 4 factorial will be 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. Now, what is important here to note is that 4 factorial is obtained by dividing 5 factorial by 5. That means the higher factorial, one more than this, if you divide by the same number, you get the next factorial. This is a very important property. We'll be talking about that also. Similarly, 3 factorial will be 3 into 2 into 1, which is actually nothing but 4 factorial by 4. Similarly, 2 factorial is 2 into 1. That's nothing but 3 factorial by 3. Correct? And 1 factorial is nothing but 1, which is 2 factorial by 2. And now 0 factorial basically leads to some kind of a inconsistency in the definition. The definition says you need to start from the number and go all the way till down to 1. So 0 factorial comes as a mathematical inconsistency over here. Now, in order to resolve this inconsistency, it was basically decided to follow this pattern that I was using up till now. So as per this pattern, the answer should be 1 factorial by 1, right? And that also comes out to be a 1. So note this down, 0 factorial is also 1, just like 1 factorial is. But remember, this is just to fill up that mathematical inconsistency. I can't go to minus 1 factorial, because if I try to go to that, basically I will be doing 0 factorial by 0. And dividing by 0 itself is not defined. Now, the moment minus 1 factorial becomes undefined, the further down I cannot go. I cannot go to minus 2 factorial, minus 3 factorial. And that's why I was trying to say that factorial only works for whole numbers. Is this fine? Any questions? Okay. Now, normally people ask me, sir, do we have to remember these factorial values? Up till 7 factorial, you should remember. Okay. 5 factorial, I've already written. Let me write down the 6 factorial also. 6 factorial is 720. And 7 factorial is 5040. Okay. Beyond that, you don't need to remember. Okay. So till 7 factorial, you should all remember. Any questions? Now, what is the physical significance of a factorial? Let's talk about that. And we'll also look into certain properties of factorial. If you have any questions with respect to what is a factorial definition, etc., please highlight. All good? Any questions? Anybody? Okay. So what is the meaning of factorial? The physical significance of a factorial is, and I'll be talking about this in our later part of our discussion. Factorial actually represents the number of ways to order n distinct objects among themselves, or taken all at a time. Okay. So if you have, let's say, 5 objects, all of them are distinct. This distinct word is very important. If they are not distinct, then you cannot use n factorial for that. So let us say there are n distinct objects given to you, and I ask them to order them among themselves. That means, you know, place them in all different orders that you can. When I say order, basically you're trying to, you know, arrange them in a linear order, in a row wise fashion. Okay. So if you try to assign a linear ordering to n distinct objects, the number of ways you can do that is actually n factorial. Let me take an example. Let's say ABC itself. In how many ways can you order ABC? Taken all at a time. So you'll say, sir, ABC, ACB, then you'll have BAC.
That's beyond my ability.
Yeah, I know it's beyond your ability. Okay, BAC, then you'll have BCA, then you'll have CAB, and then you'll have CBA, correct? So the number of ways you can order ABC among themselves or taken all at a time is basically nothing but 3 factorial. Okay, we will be talking about this when we talk about permutations. Okay, so this is one important physical significance of factorial. Now, a few properties of factorial that you should be, you know, keeping in mind. The first and the most foremost property that is going to be handy in solving most of the question is a factorial of a number is basically linked to a factorial lesser than that number by this relation. For example, 5 factorial was nothing but 5 into 4 factorial, isn't it? So this particular relation is something where you are linking a higher number factorial to a lower number factorial. Okay. Or in other words, you're writing a higher number factorial in terms of a lower number factorial. Now, this can go on and on. For example, I could still break n minus 1 factorial as n minus 1 times n minus 2 factorial. I can further break it down as n minus 1, n minus 2 times n minus 3 factorial. Correct? And this can go on and on. Now, many people ask me, sir, how do I know till where we have to stop? It all depends on the question. For example, let us say somebody has asked you, I'll just take an example question for this property. Let's say somebody has asked you to evaluate 22 factorial by 20 factorial. Right? Now, of course, you will not sit and multiply all numbers starting from 22 all the way till 1 and 20 all the way till 1, because you know that even if you multiply and you divide it, a lot of terms are going to get cancelled off, isn't it? And of course, it will look very awkward to write all those numbers and start canceling it, right? Looks very kiddish. So what we can do here is 22 being a higher number, 22 factorial can be written in terms of 20 factorial like this. 22 into 21 into 20 factorial. So you know you have to stop till 20 factorial. So as the case may be, you can stop till that factorial and you can just, you know, conclude your result. By the way, how much is this? 22 into 21? 42, I think it's 462. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns with respect to this property? So you can evaluate this pretty quickly. Okay. Next property, which I would like to mention here. In fact, it's a mention, not a property. Please understand this. Such properties do not work on factorial. Don't try to do that. X plus Y factorial doesn't mean X factorial plus Y factorial. Same goes with XY factorial. It doesn't mean X factorial, Y factorial. So don't try to extrapolate these formulas from your end. Let's say X by Y being a whole number. Let's say X by Y is a whole number. And somebody says, you know, evaluate this. It doesn't mean you do X factorial by Y factorial. Please, I know I should not even mention these things, but there were people in past who misused these properties like this. Kindly do not do that. Okay. Next thing is, if X factorial is equal to Y factorial, it either implies X is equal to Y, or X is 0, Y is 1, or X is 1, Y is 0. That's the only two possibilities. Okay. So if X factorial and Y factorial, I mean, I'm just giving you some scenario that if they're equal, either X and Y are equal. Okay. Either an XY are, you know, X and Y are, let me write it here. Yeah. Either X and Y are equal whole numbers or they are related to each other. Like X could be 0, Y could be 1, or X could be 1, Y could be 0. Okay. Is this fine? Any question with respect to what is a factorial? We'll talk more about factorial in our upcoming concepts, which is called the Lujan's formula. We'll talk about Lujan's formula in some time, but before that, I want to take some basic questions on factorial. Hello, good evening. Those who joined in late, we have started a new topic today, permutations and combinations. Right now, if you see, we are on the very first slide and we have started with the discussion on factorials. Okay. Anything that you would like to copy here, ask here, please do so. Because now I'm going to move to the next slide. Okay. All happy, all done? All right. So let's move on to the next slide. And I would take a few questions with you all. Let's take a few questions. Where is my in-class sessions? In-class. Okay. I would like to start with this question. Okay. This question says, prove that the expressions on the left-hand side simplify to 2n plus 1 factorial by n factorial. You may do the proof from any direction. You can do from right to left or left to right. That all depends on you. So please do this and do let me know when you are done. Just write it down on the chat box. Anybody? Oh, yeah, take your time. No issues. Nikhil is on. Wonderful, Nikhil. Done. Sharduli also. Very good. What about others? Dear all, everybody, please participate. Adya, Arav, Abhijay, Anushka, Arundhati, Harshita. I don't want to name everybody, but you know that you need to participate. Okay, I can only see a few handful of you participating. Yeah. Okay, so let's start this proof. Maybe I'll start with this expression, 2n plus 1, the whole factorial. Okay. Now, if you see 2n plus 1 whole factorial is basically nothing but it's a continued product. Okay, it's a continued product till 2n plus 1. Okay. Now, from every even term that you have over here, do one thing. First, separate the even terms and the odd terms from each other. Okay, so first I will write all the even terms, which is 2, 4, 6, 8, till 2n. And all the odd terms, and let me use white color font to write them, till 2n plus 1. Okay. Now, from each of these terms that you see in the yellow, which is your even terms, start pulling out a 2 each from each of the terms, right? So if you pull out a 2 from 2, you get a 1. If you pull out a 2 from 4, you get a 2. You pull out a 2 from 3, you get a, pull out a 2 from 6, you get a 3. And so on and so forth till you pull out a 2 from 2 and you get an n. Now, when you pull out the 2s from each of the terms, you know that there are n number of terms here. So ultimately, you'll get 2 to the power n, leaving behind 1, 2, 3, 4 till n. That is actually n factorial. We'll write that down a little later on. Not a worry. So this white terms, I will write it. Or I'll write them as it is. Okay. Okay. Now see here, automatically terms will start, you know, shaping up as the required expression that we need. So this is nothing but n factorial. Okay. And these terms are already present in your expression. So I will not worry too much about these because they are definitely there in your expression. Okay. Now from here, the final step is bring down that n factorial to the left hand side. And that's how your expression becomes, or that's how your left hand side and right hand side become equal to each other. Hence proved. Is it fine? So we just use the basic definition of factorial and just, you know, manipulated with the terms and got my result. Fine, easy. Any questions, any concerns? Could you take another one now? Okay, so let's take another one. Feel free to stop me if you're copying anything, okay? So when you don't say, Karthik is saying, how do you know how to separate odd and even? Right, because I saw the expression that only odd terms were seen there, Karthik. So when you're solving a question, have an eye on what you want to achieve. Okay. From there, I got the idea. Is it fine? Karthik, all good? Okay. Let's take another one. Okay, so yeah, maybe we'll take this question also. Solve for x. So it is given that x factorial upon 2 factorial x minus 2 factorial is 2. X factorial upon 4 factorial x minus 4 factorial is 2 is to 1. Solve for x. I would expect everybody to reply to this on the chat box. Don't worry about answer being right or wrong. Participation is more important. Yes, yes, it is ishtu symbol. Why there was any doubt related to that? So read it like this, Karthik. This is 2:1, something like that. And one more thing I would like to ask you here is that till what time does your school operate in the hybrid mode? Till what time was the last period? 1 o'clock. Okay, so you had enough time to reach home. Vaishnav, I hope you're not you're answering to the timing, right? Okay, 1 p.m. was the last. Okay. Okay, so, okay, Sharduli, we'll check whether there is an answer to that or not. Vaishnav, okay, very good, Vaishnav. So, Siddharth, Karthik, and Vaishnav. Yeah, I saw your answer, both of them. I saw your answer. Anybody else? Sharduli also, I got your answer. She has a different opinion. Anybody else? Nikhil, where was your answer, Nikhil? Okay, Nikhil, your answer is also okay. Okay, Tejasvini. Anybody else? Okay, fine, let's do this. See, first of all, even before you try to solve the problem, please understand factorial works only for whole numbers. So some of you who are giving the answer like half or zero, that answer cannot be your answer, because if you had zero as your answer, then your denominator here would be -2 factorial, which is not defined. Okay. Or -4 as your answer, which is not defined. Or -3/2 factorial, not defined. Okay. So the moment you get a value of x, see, they might appear in your answer. I'm not saying they will not appear while you're solving it, but it is up to you to rule them out. You'll have to discard those answers, because those will not make those factorial terms, you know, actually defined. So such terms would be neglected, that would be ignored, that will be rejected. Okay. So, okay, Tejasvi. Okay, let's discuss it out. Yeah. Ishtu means you're dividing this term by this term. So let's do that. So you're dividing this term, it will be x factorial, 4 factorial, x minus 4 factorial. Now, as I told you, factorial basically allows you to write a higher value factorial in terms of a lower value factorial. Okay. So when you do that, you can actually write 4 factorial in terms of 2 factorial. But many of you would say, sir, why to do that? This is 24. This is 2. We already know it. So make it 12. Good. Save your time. No issues. Okay. And here you have x minus 4 factorial and x minus 2 factorial. Now remember, x minus 2 is a bigger number as compared to x minus 4. So you can write x minus 2 factorial as x minus 2, x minus 3 into x minus 4 factorial, right? Just score these two off, okay? And now you have x minus 2, x minus 3. I am taking it to the right-hand side and I'm bringing this 2 down under 12, which is 6. Now, many of you would have got a quadratic expression over here, okay? But you don't have to go into quadratic also for solving this. Now, listen to this. Very, very useful piece of advice that I'm going to give you here. You know that these are two consecutive numbers, right? X minus 2 and x minus 3 are consecutive. Okay, this is the higher, this is the smaller of the two. So, right, and both of them have to be natural numbers. Remember that. Remember, x itself has to be a natural number or whole number, to be more precise, for x factorial to be existing, isn't it? So, try to break 6 as product of two consecutive whole numbers. And the only possibility to do that is 3 into 2, which means you can do a direct comparison. You can directly say x minus 2 is a 3, or you'd say x minus 3 is a 2. It doesn't make any difference. Either of the case, you will get x value as a 5 only. So this is the only possibility. This is the only answer. Any other answer that you would write would lead to it being wrong. No worries, Shardali. It's okay. Kartik, clear? Everybody is clear? Okay. Let's take another one. Anything that you would like to ask or know, please do ask. Okay. This approach which I have told you in the last step, that is very important and very handy to solve few of the questions. Little later on, I will take that up in later part of the topic. Okay, so next question that we are going to take up is, here I'm going to change a question slightly. I'm going to first ask you to do the sum till 1 to, let's say, 50. 1 to 50. N is 50 here. I will come to N also, don't worry. But as of now, I would like you to sum up R into R factorial from R equal to 1 till 50. R equal to 1 till 50. Question is clear? So question is, I wanted to sum 1 into 1 factorial, 2 into 2 factorial, 3 into 3 factorial, all the way, let's say, till 50 terms, which is 50 into 50 factorial. So what is the answer here? That is what I need to figure out. Of course, your answer should also, answer will be in terms of factorial only. Don't try to literally add them because these numbers are too big. Okay. Excellent, Nikhil. Very good. Awesome. Great. Your answer is absolutely right. Anybody else? Now, I'm sure most of you would be struggling to, you know, start actually in this, right? Because, you know, you have definitely done your, you know, summation chapter, the series topic that we did in the last class. But even, you know, with that knowledge, how do you do this? Because, you know, factorials are coming into picture. Now, not to worry. There is one special method which I discussed in the last class, which was called the VN method, right? I'll be using my VN method in this scenario as well. Let's see how. Zero, Ara, why? Such a big number you're calling as zero. All of them are positive. Why they should add up to give you a zero? Okay, never mind. We'll check it out. See. So first of all, write down the Rth term over here. The Rth term over here is R into R factorial, which is already given to you in the expression itself. Now write down this R as R plus 1 minus 1. Okay. And let's expand this by, you know, clubbing R plus 1 together, and this 1 is separate. So when you multiply it, it gives you R plus 1 times R factorial minus R factorial, right? Now, what is R plus 1 into R factorial? What is this R plus 1 into R factorial? R plus 1 factorial, correct? Now, here is the thing which I was basically talking in our VN method of summation last class, that basically I have expressed Rth term as difference of two such terms which are coming from the same function, where one has an R, another has an R plus one or R minus one. So in this case, something similar to that has happened. So what is the advantage of writing R into R factorial like this? Now you yourself can see here, when you start putting your R value as a one, let's say when you put R as one, you get this as two factorial minus one factorial. When you put R as two, you get this three factorial minus two factorial. When you put R as three, you get this as four factorial minus three factorial. Now let's say I want to go till the 50th term. So let's write 49th term over here, which is going to be 50 factorial minus 49 factorial. Why did we write R as R plus one? I never wrote R as R plus one. I wrote R as R plus one minus one. That's Rx, right, Pratej? Isn't R plus one minus one an R? Correct? Now, if you're asking what was the reason for writing it like this, is because my purpose was to break it up as difference of two factorials, both coming from the same functionality. Right? Okay. Yeah. So the last term that would be T50 would be 51 factorial. 51 factorial minus 50 factorial. Now let's add them. That's what we are basically, you know, looking for. We are looking for the sum of R into R factorial from 1 to 50. As you can see, there would be a cancellation of these alternative terms. Okay, ultimately leading to, terms in between, ... they will also get cancelled off. So ultimately leaving you with 51 factorial minus 1 factorial, right? And there you go. The answer for this particular series is going to be 51 factorial minus 1. Now, can we generalize this? Can we generalize this act and try to answer the initial question which I had given, where there was an N here? So in that case, what would be your answer? Please write down, everybody. So in general, if you try to sum up this from R equal to 1 till N, what should be the answer coming up? Absolutely. N plus 1 factorial minus 1. Is it fine? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns with respect to the solution? Okay. Now, the next important concept, which is actually associated with factorial, is the Lujon's formula. Let's talk about that. Anything that you would like to copy, ask in the slide, please do so. Great. Okay, let's move on to the next one. So the next thing that we are going to talk about is okay. Now you can see on your screen, I have written a spelling, legendre, but it is not pronounced like this. Okay. So it is pronounced as Lujon. Okay. Lujon's formula. So what is this Lujon formula? Lujon formula is basically a formula given to us by a French mathematician. Okay. Of course, his name was Lujon, where he basically helped us, or where basically he discussed how to find out the exponent of a prime number. Exponent of a prime number in factorial of a number. Okay. So basically he gave an idea or formula from where we can actually figure out that if you prime factorize a factorial of a number, then what would be the power? Exponent is power. So what would be the power of any of the prime numbers in the prime factorization? I'm sure most of you would have prime factorized numbers in your junior classes, right? We normally call them as writing it as a canonical form. Okay. So let's say I take an example. Maybe let's say 4 factorial. 4 factorial we know is 24. Okay. If you prime factorize 24, what do you get? You'll say I get 2 to the power 3 into 3 to the power 1. Correct? So Lujon formula basically helped you to find out what would be the power on any prime number, which basically occur in the prime factorization of the factorial of that number. Okay. And he basically gave a symbol for this. He called it as EPN factorial, just to make it a notation. E means exponent, P is the prime number, and n factorial is of course the number from where you are trying to find the exponent. So if I say what is the exponent of 2 in 4 factorial, what will you say? What will you say? What is the 3, correct? What is the exponent of 3 in 4 factorial? What will you say? 1. Okay. Now, of course, this number was small enough and you could factorize it and figure it out. But what if the number is big enough? Let's say I gave you 100 factorial and ask you, hey, what is the exponent of 2 or maybe 3 or maybe 5 in 100 factorial? How would you figure that out? For that, Lujan gave a formula to us. Our assumption, no, it's an example. No, don't say, don't call it as an assumption. Pratesh, we took an example to, this is an example which I'm taking. All right, okay. So now the formula basically evolves like this. I mean, I will be writing down the formula and then we will justifying why he or how he got that formula actually. So Lujan said that the exponent of any prime number P in factorial of a number is given by GIF of n by p plus GIF of n by p square plus GIF of n by p cube till you start getting zero. Okay, till you start getting a zero. So there would be a case where your p to the power some power s will exceed n. In that case, you'll start getting zero, isn't it? Okay. So here this square bracket that I have written basically represents the greatest integer function, GIF, greatest integer function. Okay. Now, how possibly would you have got this formula? Let's try to understand from this example itself. Okay. So in 4 factorial, what is the exponent of 2? Let's try to figure it out. I know you have already, you know, written the answer 3, but let's try to figure it out. So 4 factorial is what? 4 factorial is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4. Okay. So what do you do to figure out how many 2s are there in this product? What does the common sense, you know, say? In order to know how many 2s are there in this product, what are you going to do? The first thing that I would do is I will pull out the 2 from every even number. Correct? Because I know every even number will at least contribute 1, 2, isn't it? So there is an even number 2 here, there is an even number 4 here. I will take out 1, 1, 2 from both of them. Correct? So this will contribute a 2, this will contribute a 2, right? So let me just keep a tag of the number of 2s. So I'll only get 1, 2 from here and 1, 2 from here. Correct? Right? But remember, there is a number over here which has actually got 2 2s, isn't it? And that number here is 4. So that number will contribute 1 more 2, right? In short, can I say all multiples of 2 is contributing 1, 1, 2 at least? All multiples of 4 will contribute 1 more set of 2s. Similarly, all multiple of 8s will contribute further 1 more set of 2s, and so on and so forth. Correct? Isn't it? So 1, 1, 2 you already got from here, and this guy 4 will give you 1 more 2. Isn't it? So now this 2 that you have got, it's actually the number of factors of 2s that you have in this particular continued product. And that is only 2 in number. If you write GIF, that doesn't change the value. It is still a 2. But how many 4s you have from 1 to 4? You will say, sir, only 1, which is actually 4 by 4, and 4 by 4 is 2 factorial. And that is what basically your Lujan formula also gave you, right? And that's how you get your answer as a 3. Let me take one more example. Okay, from that example, further things will be clarified. Okay, let us say my question is, find the exponent of 2 in, let's say, 12 factorial. Okay. So find the exponent of 2 in 12 factorial. So how will I find this out? Okay. Now I'm solving this problem from common sense point of view. I'm not using the formula. So let's try to see whether the formula is coming from some logic or not. So if you start writing 12, It's not many numbers. I'll write it down. No worries. Okay. So first I'm going to do, I'm going to pick out 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2 from every multiple of 2s. How many multiples of 2s will be there from 1 to 12? How many multiples of 2 are there? 5. Count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6, isn't it? This 6 comes actually when you do 12 by 2, isn't it? Okay. Now GIF is put just to ensure that we are not taking this, you know, if let's say fraction comes, fraction should not be taken into account. Okay. So 6 twos I already got. Okay. So think as if I make a very, you know, interesting scenario out of it. Let's say you are a tax collector. Okay. Your tax is the number 2. So you are collecting 2 from the people who can provide you 2. Okay. So first, what did you do? You said you asked all the even numbers. Hey, you all have a 2, right? Give me 2. Okay. So you're like collecting the tax, and that tax is that 2s. Okay. So these even numbers, they will say, okay, take my two. All the 6 numbers gave you the 2, right? But there are some rich people also who have more than 1 2s, like 4, 8, 12, correct? These guys will have 2 2s, right? So they can further give you more 2s. That's what happens in our country, correct? Rich people have to pay more tax, isn't it? Poor people don't pay more tax, correct? Right? That is a socialized, you know, what do you call this? Socialistic pattern of governance, right? So these numbers, 4, 8, 12, they are rich people in terms of 2. So they can give one more set of 2s. So they have already lost a 2. But they still have more 2 with them. So more money is there in their pockets. So government will try to take that out also, right? So they will further lose one more set of 2s. And how many set of 2s will come from here? As many number of factors of 4 are present. So how many factors of 4 are present from 1 to 12? You can literally count it actually. 4, 8, 12, 3, which is equivalent to saying 12 by 2 square. Okay. Is it fine? Any questions? But there are some people who are having more 2s. This guy 8. This guy has got 3 2s. So even after losing one hair and after losing one hair, it is still having more money with him or more 2s with him. So do you think government is going to leave him? No. More, you know, they have to give more taxes. So you have to find how many factors of 8s are there and how those many factors of 8 will contribute one more set of 2s. So you just keep on adding it. Okay. Now, any more, you know, factor will not be there because, you know, they have all lost all the 2s that you can give. So literally counting, your number of 2s will be 6 plus 3 plus 1. That means 10 2s can be picked out. So if at all you decide to prime factorize 12 factorial, then 2 will have a power of 10. Of course, there will be some power of 3. There will be some power of 5. I'm not getting into details of it. My question was only to get what is the exponent of the prime number 2 in the prime factorization of 12 factorial. And that answer is 10. Okay. Now here, literally, you can count and verify. So this has 1 2. This has got 2 2s. This has also got 1 2. This has got 3 2s. Okay. This has also got 1 2. This has got 2 2s. So literally count 1, 3, 4, 7, 10. 10 is the answer. Okay. So this whole activity, the French mathematician Lujon converted like a formula like this way, and he made our life very, very easy. So you don't have to literally see, find out all those things. Is the justification from why he gave this formula clear to everybody? Some people are joining late. Please understand the seriousness of these classes. Joining late means you will not get the context of what is going on. Right? People who have joined now, 2 of you have joined now. I don't know who all. You will not understand what's going on. Okay. See, Setu, you need to collect the 2s from all the terms which can give you 2. And you have to add how many 2s you have collected. That is the exponent of 2 in a number, right? Correct? Have you seen that old 2 rupee note? Nowadays, many people don't use it. Now there are coins. No? Okay, so when we were small, no, my mom used to give me 2 rupees, okay, for you know getting some kind of snacks in the school, okay, but my dad used to give me 5 rupees, okay, because of course big heart my dad. So if let's say, you know, there are 12 students, okay, and they are carrying 2 rupees with them, okay, so this guy only has 1 2 rupee, think like that. Okay, and this guy has got 2 2 rupees. This guy has got 3 2 rupees. This guy has got 1 2 rupee, 1 3 rupee, like that. Okay, anyways, so let's say you are a person who is coming to take taxes from them and you are collecting only 2 rupees from them. How many 2 rupees can this guy provide you? He'll say, only 1 2 rupee I have, take it. This guy can provide 2 2 rupees to you. This guy can also provide 1 2 rupee to you only because he has got 1 2 rupee and 1 3 rupee. Think like that. Okay, so like that, you are collecting all the twos that you can collect from these numbers and trying to see how many twos you have collected. That is what we are trying to find out in this topic. What is this formula for, Tejaswini? For a bigger number, this formula will be used. These are all smaller versions of the same formula, right? Let's take a question. Then you will understand how you can collect the twos from a bigger number. Okay. Let's say I ask you, what is the exponent of 2 from 100 factorial? Okay. Find exponent of 2 from 100 factorial. Of course, you can't sit and multiply till 100. So for that, we will use the Lujan's formula. As per Lujan's formula, the number of twos that you will get would be the value that you are going to get from this operation. So Lujan formula is a way to figure out those value, that exponent, isn't it? Okay, now tell me where to stop, because I don't want to unnecessarily write terms which will give you 0. Should I stop here or should I go further? 2 to the power 7 is 128. So if I divide 100 by 128, I'll get a fraction, and GIF of a fraction will be 0, isn't it? So now count. GIF of 2 by 50, 100 by 2 is 50. This is going to be 25. Now, there's an easier way to calculate it. You don't have to always sit and find this value. Just keep dividing the previous answer by a 2 and take the GIF. So 25 by 2 is 12.5. Take a GIF, it will be 12. 12 by 2, 6. 6 by 2, 3. 3 by 2, GIF will be 1. Okay, so if you add it, you'll end up getting, I think, 75, 87 plus 10, 97. Okay, so Tejaswini, had you factorized 100 factorial as 2 to the power something, 3 to the power something, 5 to the power something, da 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 da, then that 2 there will have a 97 on the power. Understood? How does this formula work? Any questions, anybody? Okay, so if you are clear with this, let me ask you a question. Find exponent of 5 in 100 factorial. Find exponent of 5 in 100 factorial. Very good, Shalvili. Nikhil, very good. Vashnav, excellent. Very good. So the answer will be simple. 100 by 5. 100 by 5 square. Now, beyond that, I need not go because 100 by 5 cube will lead to a 0. Okay, so all the other terms will be 0, 0. So it's as good as saying 20 plus 4. Which is 24. Okay. So this term which I had left here, actually this will be 24. Okay. Now use this result, the 2 result, and tell me the answer to this question. Tell me the answer to this question. How many zeros are there at the end of 100 factorial? Use the 2 results which I have just now written over here. Excellent, Nikhil. Correctism.
I didn't catch that. Could you try again?
Correct, Shardali. Very good. 121. Oh my God, why? Correct, Setu. Correct, Shalini. Okay, the answer to this question is 24 again. Why? Now see, very simple. In order to make a zero at the end of a number, that it means how many tens you have multiplied it with. Correct? So let's say the count of the number of zeros at the end of the number is basically how many tens are there in the, you know, that number. That means how many tens are required or how many tens are getting formed in that number, isn't it? Now, in order to make a 10, you need two prime numbers. One is 2, another is 5. Correct? So, in order to make 110, you need 12 and you need 15. Now, think as if you're talking in terms of chemistry, limiting reagent. I'm sure you have done stoichiometry, right? Concept of limiting reagent. What is a limiting reagent? So, when there are multiple reactants which are giving you a product, right? And of course, you have been given some quantities of those reactants. Then the one which is in a smaller quantity, that is the limiting reagent, because that fellow decides how much product will get formed, isn't it? So now think as if 1 mole of 2 and 1 mole of 5 react to give you 1 mole of 10. Okay. And in 100 factorial, there are 97 moles of 2 and only 24 moles of 5. Then how many moles of 10 will be created? 24 moles of 10, because this is the limiting reagent. Correct? So I'm talking in terms of chemistry. I hope that makes sense to you. So out of 2 and 5, 5 is in a lesser quantity. And it will always be in a lesser quantity because the higher number will occur lesser number of times in the factorial of a number. Okay? So in case of 100 factorial, the number of zeros at the end will be decided by how many 5s are there in the prime factorization of 100 factorial, and there are only 24. So since there are only 24, this is your limiting reagent. A limiting reagent. I'm writing it down in terms of, you know, chemistry language. Since this is a limiting reagent, there will be only 24 tens created. Okay. So if there are only 24 tens created, then 100 factorial will end in 24 zeros. Zeros, you can write it as zeros also, res also. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. So just to test you on this concept further, I will give you one more question. Can I go to the next slide? Okay. Find exponent of 12 in 50 factorial. Okay, Vaishnav. Okay, Setu. Okay, Shalini. Three answers so far. Four answers so far. Very good, Shardali, Arav. Anybody else who would like to contribute? Okay. Now I'm getting three types of answers. In fact, I'm getting mostly two types of answers. Okay, let's discuss them. Oh, yeah, yeah, why not? Vaishnav, if you want to change your answer, please go ahead. No issues. Okay, okay. Do it. Okay. Now, some of you are giving me the answer for this as 4. Maybe because you're doing this. Okay. That's why you're getting your answer as a 4. This is wrong. Can you tell me why it is wrong? It's because you have not read the name of the topic properly. Let me go back. Read the name of the topic once again, loudly. Exponent of a prime number in n factorial. My dear students, is 12 a prime number for you? Huh? That's what. Pay attention. See, these are small things where you will be caught off guard. Okay. 12 is not a prime number. This formula is not going to work. Now, why is this formula not going to work? Why did I just cross it out? Is because, see, a prime number cannot be made from several factors other than the number itself and 1. But a non-prime number, let's say I want to make a 12. I want to count how many 12s can be made. 12s is not only made by numbers which are multiples of 12, or let's say multiples of 12 square or whatever. They can also be made by multiples of, let's say, 3 and 4. Correct. Are you getting my point? Because of those issues coming up, you cannot use this notation to get your exponent of 12. So first of all, what is the meaning of exponent of 12 in 50 factorial? That means how many 12s you can get from 50 factorial, right? If I have to extract all 12s from 50 factorial, of course, leaving behind an integer, how many such 12s I can pull out? That is what the question is asking. So here the concept is same as what we did for x, no, finding how many tens are there in 100 factorial. So 12 as a number is what? 12 as a number is 2 to the power 2 into 3 to the power 1, right? So see what prime numbers are involved in making a 12. Only 2 and 3 are involved in making a 12, isn't it? And that too, 2 moles of 2, again, I'm using chemistry language. 2 moles of 2 and 1 mole of 3 is required to make 1 mole of 12. Okay. Now see, first figure out how many 2s are present in 50 factorial. Let's answer this question. You will say, sir, simple. Now I can use my Lujan's formula. So it's GIF of 50 by 2, GIF of 50 by 2 square, GIF of 50 by 2 cube, GIF of 50 by 2 to the power 4, GIF of 50 by 2 to the power 5. I think beyond this, I need not go because 2 to the power 6 is going to be 64, and that's going to give me a 0, 0. So this is 25, this is 12, this is 6, this is 3, this is 1. How much? 37. 37 was 10, 47. So there are 47 2s present in 50 factorial. How many 3s are present in 50 factorial? Let's figure that out as well. So that's going to be GIF of 50 by 3, GIF of 50 by 3 square, GIF of 50 by 3 cube. I think beyond that, I need not go because 3 cube is going to be 90, 3 to the power 4 is going to be 81, and that's going to give me a 0. So this is as good as a 16, 5, 1. Correct? So that's going to be 22 in number. Okay. Now, again, ask yourself, 1 mole of 3 and 2 moles of 2 make 1 mole of 12. You have 22 moles of 3. You have 47 moles of 2. Which of the two is the limiting reagent? Right, Vaishnav? Which of the two is the... Right, this yellow is the limiting reagent. Right? So 22 threes will actually require just 44 twos to make 22 twelves, right? And two is in abundance. We have 47 twos present. There are only 44 of them required. Okay. So 22 threes require 44 twos to generate 22 twelves. So the exponent of 12, even though, you know, we are writing this expression, so the exponent of 12 in the 50 factorial will only be 22, because only 22 12s can be generated. Okay. Remaining three twos will be wasted, not be utilized in making a 12. Is it fine? So the answer to this question is 22. The first one to get this right, and let me name the student. The first one to get this right was, I think, Sharduli. Yeah, Sharduli and Arav Sinha. Excellent. Very good. Won't this be an exponent of 6? 6 also will be, you know, 22 only. Because to form a 6, you need 1, 3 and a 1, 2. Okay, so 22, 6 can only be formed. So if somebody asks you what is the exponent of 6 in 50 factorial, that will also be 22. Okay. Setu, clear? Yeah, Vaishnav, it's okay. Is it fine? Great. Now with this, I'm going to begin with our main part of our chapter, the basic part of our chapter, and that is called the fundamental principle of counting. Fundamental principle of counting. Now these principles are called fundamental because they are very fundamental to our logical way of counting. Right? So fundamental that you can't explain it also why we are doing it like this. Okay. So it's like, you know, fundamental forces, like gravitation is one of the fundamental forces, right? We know there is a gravitational attraction between two celestial bodies or any two bodies for that matter. But why do they attract each other? Why there's a gravitational pull between two bodies? Very difficult to, you know, explain that. Scientists are still working on it. Setu has some question. Let's resolve that first. Sir, 11 for 12 because there are 22 twos. So there are 11 fours. See, to make 1 12, you need 2 twos, right? And you need 1 3. Correct? No. And you have been given 47 twos and only 22 threes. So those 22 threes will react with, I'm using the chemical language, react with 44 twos to generate 22 twelves. What is the doubt then? That four that will be left off. You're talking about the three twos that will be left off, right? These three twos do not have any threes left to make a 12. Ah, now you understood. Okay. Now let's talk about fundamental principle of counting. So primarily we are going to talk about two fundamental principle of counting, which is fundamental principle of addition and fundamental principle of multiplication. However, there is one more interesting fundamental principle, which is called the principle of inclusion exclusion, which we'll be talking about later in our chapter, much later, when we talk about distribution of distinct objects in different groups, and also when we talk about derangement concepts. Now, what is this fundamental principle of addition? What is this addition fundamental principle? Now, see, I'll give you a simple scenario, very simple scenario. Let us say there is a movie theater, okay? And you are inside the movie theater, okay? Now, after the movie is over, there are multiple exit gates, right? You would have all experienced it. Some people are leaving from front, some people are leaving from back, some people are leaving from sides, multiple ways they leave, okay? So let's say there are three exit doors from here and there are four exit doors from here, okay? Tell me, if there are three doors from here and there are four doors from here, how many ways can you exit this cinema theater? Right. How many ways can you, number of ways to leave the, a number of ways to exit the cinema theater? What is the number of ways? Seven. Seven is nothing but 3 plus 4, isn't it? You added 3 and 4, right? You got 7 as your answer. Now, do you have any answer? Why did you add them? Why not 3 to the power 4? Why not 4 to the power 3? Why not 3 into 4? Why did you add them? Now, I know these type of questions are difficult to answer because they are so fundamental, isn't it? Some fundamental things are very difficult to explain. Okay. Now, basically, you say, sir, I could do this task of, you know, getting out of the cinema theater in the following ways. I can go out of this door, or I could go out of this door, or 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 this. So the moment you're saying or, logically, it means you have to add. Okay. So it's a logical connection by which you are adding it, right? There's no hardcore derived formula that, okay, this means it has to add. Okay. So intuitively or logically speaking, you are adding it, isn't it? Okay. So this thing has been put as a principle. And the principle says that if there is a task, okay, if there is a task which you can accomplish by doing any one of these, let's say, no cases, let's say case one, case two, case three, etc. I'm just putting some dot, dot, dot. Okay, so let's say case n. So if you're basically trying to do a task by doing any one of these, you know, cases independently, then the total number of ways of doing this task will be the sum of the number of ways of accomplishing these cases. Right? So let me write this in the English language so that later on when you're referring to your notes, you're clear of what basically I'm trying to say here. So let's say if your task, what happened to my marker? Yeah. If the task can be accomplished by independently performing the subtasks under the following cases: 1, 2, 3, and so on. Okay. Then the total number of ways of completing the given task is equal to sum of the number of ways to do case one, case two, case three tasks. Okay. So here, what was your task? Your task was to get out of the cinema theater, right? So there are several cases. You can get out of the cinema theater if you step out from door number one, that's case one, or door number two, case two, or door number three, case three, or door number four, case four, like that. So you can also say that you can take any one of the doors to your left. Okay. So there are three such ways to do that task. Or you could take any of the doors on the right of you. There are four doors present there. So let's say I briefly divide it into just two cases, case one and case two. So case one is taking a door to your left. Case two is taking a door to your right. So taking a door to your left, you have only three ways. Taking a door to your right, there are four ways to do it. So 3 plus 4, that is the sum of the ways that in which you can do case one and case two. If you add them, that will give you the total number of ways of doing that, you know, task of getting out of the cinema theater. Okay. Now, these all things look very simple, but when it comes to application in questions, many people like confused, so do I add them? Do I multiply them? All these kind of questions start coming up. Looks very trivial, very simple. But when it comes to its application, people do lot of mistakes. Is it fine? Okay. Now, let me take another question here. Let us say in your classroom, there are 5 boys and let's say 6 girls. Okay. You want to choose a class monitor. Okay. How many ways can you choose a class monitor? 11, right? So now, how do you read this task? Your task is to make a monitor. So now you will think, okay, I can make a monitor if I choose a boy. Correct? That's case one. Or you could also choose a monitor if you choose a girl. Now, both of them are independently helping you to choose a monitor. Isn't it? So the class monitor could be either a boy, job is over, or a class monitor could be a girl, job is over. So both of the choices would help you accomplish that task. So just find out how many ways can you choose a boy. There are five boys, so five ways to choose a boy. How many ways can you choose a girl? Six ways to choose a girl, because there are six girls in the class. So 5 plus 6, 11. So the number of ways in which you can choose a monitor is 11. So you added them. Okay, is it fine? Any doubt related to what is the addition principle of counting? Right. So whenever you use the word cases, whenever you use the word this or this or this or this, so they are all indicative that you need to add. That is why I always encourage students to, you know, speak the task in their mind. When they speak the task, they automatically start using the word or and and. And the moment they do that, they know whether they have to add or whether they have to multiply. So multiplication is the next thing that we are going to talk about. So multiplication principle of counting. Again, let me take an example for the same. Let us say the same cinema theater. Okay, this time I give you a task that, could you go back? What do you want to copy here? Anything that you want to copy? None? Okay. Yeah. So let's say now the same cinema theater has got 3 entry doors. Okay, so these are entry doors. And let's say 5 exit doors. Okay, 5 exit doors. Okay. Now there is a task which I'm giving you. You need to enter the cinema theater. Okay, so what's your task? Task is to enter the cinema theater, entry and exit. Okay, entry and exit. What is very important? How many ways can you do it? Right, absolutely right. So you'll say, sir, 3 ways to enter and 5 ways to exit, and you eventually ended up multiplying it. Was there any justification for it? The justification is, for every entry, you have 5 exits, right? So entry number 1, you can take 5 exits, entry number 2, 5, entry number 3, 5. So basically you'll end up getting 15 such, you know, answer, and you get it by multiplication. Now here, let's generalize it. What was happening here? So there was a task, and this task was made up of several subtasks. Okay. And in order to consider the task to be completed, you have to complete all the subtasks. Let's say there are K subtasks. Okay. So in this case, there was only 2 subtasks, entry and exit. Right. So if you have a task which is made up of, let's say, K subtasks, and you have to perform all of them to consider the task to be done. Even if you miss one of them, the task will be incomplete, right? So then this principle says the number of ways to do the task. So let me define here. Let's say a task is accomplished. Let me write it down. If a task is accomplished by completing all the subtasks associated with it, then the total number of doing the task or completing the task, the task is equal to the product of the number of ways of doing the subtasks. Okay. So here, the subtask associated with this particular task was entry and exit. Entry is a subtask, exit as a subtask. And both of them have to be completed. Then only your task of entering and coming out will be completed. So you calculated how many ways to do the subtask of entry, 3 ways. How many ways to do the subtask of exit, 5 ways. And means multiplication. You multiplied and then you got your answer, isn't it? Now again, this looks very simple when I explain it in this example. But trust me, many people really get confused when to add and when to take multiplication. Okay. So we'll do some initial questions to understand this concept. And let me also tell you, dear students, that these are the formative part of your understanding of counting. NPR, NCR, etc., the formula that you have already learned in your school, they all come from these fundamental principles, right? So all your concepts are built on this. So if these are shaky, then those formulas are not going to save you. Okay. So these are the foundation. So understand this. Don't be in a search of a formula to solve all the questions. Instead of search for what principle or what logic are they connected with and what principle I can apply to solve those questions. We'll take examples. Don't worry. Setu, you're done. Can I go to the next slide? Done. Okay. My battery, laptop battery is discharging. Once again. Let's begin with a question. How many different signals can be given using any number of flags from 4 flags of different colors? Okay, remember you need at least one flag to make a signal. So consider yourself to be a station master. Okay, and trains are plying. So you need to make signals out of certain combination of flags. Okay, and you can use any number of flags, but of course minimum is one. You have to use one to make a signal. And you've been provided with 4 colors. How many different signals can you generate from those 4 colors provided to you? Okay, Shardali. Please note that if you alter the positions of the flags, it will count as a different signal. Let's say you had a flag of red color, yellow color, blue color, and green color. Okay. So let's say you decided to make a 2-color flag. So red up, yellow below. If you interchange their positions, let's say white, yellow up, and red below, it will be counted as a different signal altogether. No worries, Shardari. Change your answer if you want to. Very good, Setu. Excellent. Okay, Tejaswini, Karthik, Siddharth. Nice. Good. Shaina, very good. Arav, good. Again, good to see you, participating. Good doesn't mean your answer is correct. So just, I'm happy to see you participating. Yeah. Anybody else who wants to participate? Okay, Shardali has come back with a different answer. Pratej, very good. Manu. Anybody else who would like to answer? Tejaswini wants to change. Okay, Tejaswini. Okay, good. Ah, you can make a signal with 4 flag also. Why not? Noel, very good. Okay, let's discuss this. See, I feel that you have 4 cases to accomplish your task. You can either make a signal with single flag. So that's a case 1. Okay, case 1. Or you could make a signal with 2 flags. Okay, second case. Or you could make a signal with 3 flags. Okay. Looks like flag of Nepal, right? Nepali flag is triangular, right? Is there any country which has triangular flags? I mean, if you know any. Nepal for sure has triangular flags. Okay. Anyways. Okay, Prisham. So Prisham also has changed her answer. So now these are the four ways in which your task can be independently accomplished. Isn't it? So one flag signal is considered to be a signal. Why not? Job is done. I have to make a signal. No, job is done. But I have several other ways to do it. So two flag signal, three flag signal, four flag signal. Okay, now let's count. How many ways can you make a single flag signal? You'll say, sir, four options only. I could make a red color flag or a yellow or a blue or a green, four color. Okay. So four colors are four ways to make a single color flag. Okay. How many ways can you make a two flag signal? Now you'll say, sir, if I choose this in four ways, then this I can only choose in three ways because one flag is already used up in the first one. Now, will you add these four and three or will you multiply this four and three? Multiply. Why you will multiply? Because fundamental principle of multiplication says if your task is made up of two subtasks and both of them have to be done because you are making a two signal flag. So if the first flag and the second flag both have to be put. If you put one, your job is not over. Right? You have to put both of them. So by fundamental principle, you need to multiply them. So this answer will be 4 into 3. Same way, can I say this will be 4, 3, 2, and by fundamental principle, it will be multiplied. And the other guy will be 4, 3, 2, 1, which you actually can call 4 factorial also. Okay. So now, what will I do with these four numbers which I have circled? Should I add them or should I multiply them? Add them, right? Because independently, you are accomplishing the task. Okay. So the answer will be 4 plus 12 plus 24 plus 24. And that answer is 64 ways you can make a signal. So this station master can generate 64 signals just by those four flags. Sufficient for 64 events. Maybe, you know, just to show that a train is coming from the other side or maybe some, you know, child or a aged person is trying to cross anything. I mean, just giving examples. Is it fine? Any questions? Great. Can I move on to the next one? All right. Let's take this one. Please don't worry about the question number starting from 23. Just think as if this is 1, 2, 3 question. All right. So the first question, I'll put the poll on for this. Let's read the question first. Four prizes are distributed among five students. The 23rd question says, if no student gets more than one prize, find the number of ways in which this distribution can be done. Just to answer 23rd question, I'm putting the poll on. I hope you can all see the poll on your screen. So you told change in the color also is a signal. Yeah, I told that. So what happened? Does it change the answer, Pratesh? No, no need to do into two. Why will you do two? When you said there are four ways to choose the first flag, even if you're changing it, that four also accomplish the other change, right? Let's say blue is coming first and then red. Then red is coming, then blue. So blue and red are coming in the first position. That is counted under four only, no? Why will you do into two? Okay. Oh, wow. I've already got eight responses, less than a minute. Good, good, good. People are fast. Actually, this chapter is a touch and go chapter. I mean, you don't have, you know, a lot of solving inside, but yes, initial thinking, initial phrasing of your scenario in your mind is important. Okay, I'll give you 30 more seconds and then we'll discuss it. So people who are answering or want to answer, please do so within 30 more seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, even if you want to take an intelligent guess, please go for it. 10 of you have not responded. Fast. I'm closing the poll. Okay. Most of you have said option number B. Let's discuss it out. See, what is the scenario? The scenario is you have to distribute 4 prizes among 5 students. And no student gets more than 1 prize. Okay. Now, what is your task? Task is to give away the prizes. So you have prize P1, you have prize P2, you have prize P3, and you have prize P4. How many ways can you give off prize P1? How many ways can you give off prize P1? 5 ways, correct? How many ways can you give prize P2? Please keep in mind that no student should get more than 1 prize. Now, the person who has got prize P1, he is not eligible to take P2. Right? 1 prize, he is, you know, not counted in our, you know, eligibility for P2. Right? So P2 will have only 4 options. Right? Similarly, P3 will only have 3 options. That means the people who have, or the students who have received prize P1 and P2, they are not eligible to receive prize P3. Similarly, P4 can be received by only 2 students. So now, what should I do? Add them or multiply them? Sir, if you add them, none of the options will match. Okay, that's a smart way to solve the problem. We'll multiply it. Why? Because I have to give prize P1 and P2 and P3 and P4. See, I'm always using this connector and. Means multiplication. So this answer is going to become 120. Option number B is definitely right. Well done, students. Okay. Simple, easy thing. Yeah, I mean, this is not a rocket science. You know, you just have to use your understanding. Break it up into tasks and see how the work can be done. The task can be done. Okay, next one. I'm again relaunching my poll. The next question says, if each student is eligible for all the prizes, find the number of ways in which this task can be done. And this is the simplest question. Oh, wow. 3 people have already answered. 4 have already answered. 5 have already answered. Good. And all of them have given me the same response. Good. I think we can close this within 1 minute. That's such an easy question. Right, Siddharth. Okay. Last 20 seconds. Those who want to vote, please do so. Five. Four. 3, 2, 1, go. Oh, it was supposed to be 100% vote for option A, but unfortunately 2 students voted for B and C. Okay, so out of 16, 14 say A, 1 student say B and C. Maybe out of desperation, you have pressed on some poll button. See, very simple. Again, my task is what? My task is to give away these 4 prizes, P1 and P2 and P3 and P4. How many ways can I give off prize P1? You'll say 5. How many ways I can give off P2? Again, 5, because the student who has received P1, he's also eligible to receive P2, because as the question says, each student is eligible to receive all the prizes. Okay. So 5 into 5 into 5, because you have to give off all the prizes. So 5 to the power 4, that's nothing but 625. Option number A is correct. Can we now do the 25th one as well? Let me launch the poll for that as well. Read the question carefully. Question says, if no student gets all the prizes, find the number of ways in which these prizes can be distributed. Good, good, good. So 7 of you have voted. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Please vote. Enough time has been given for this. Okay, great. So 14 of you have voted, out of which 10 of you say option number B, which is 620. Let's check whether 620 is correct or not. See here, the question says that there should not be any case where all the prizes are backed by one student. Okay. So can I say there are only 5 such cases? Okay. Where all the prizes go to a single student, right? Let's say student number 1 bagging all the 4 prizes. That's one case. Student number 2 bagging all the prizes. Second case. Student number 3 bagging all the prizes. Third case. Student number 4 bagging all the prizes, fourth case, and student number 5 bagging all the prizes, that is the fifth case, right? Now, from the total number of cases that you have, that is, there is no restriction at all. That means any number of prizes can be given to any number of students if you remove these 5 cases. So 625 was a case where there was no restriction. From those cases, if you remove the 5 such cases where all the prizes go to one particular student, you will be left with such cases where not all the prizes go to a single student. That means a student can get at the max 3 prizes, not all the 4. Okay. So this is a way which we solve, which we use, and this is called the exclusion way of solving the problem. So instead of doing all permutation combination, let's figure out in how many ways can the task be actually not done. That means if you want to give all the prizes, right? How many ways can you do it? So there are only 5 ways in which you can give all the prizes to a single student. Those 5 ways, just remove them. Remove them from what? Total number of cases, which is 625. So the remaining case, which is 620, is the number of ways where no student will get all the prizes. Right? But still, there are cases here where a student can get more than one prize also, but he will not get all the prize. That is for sure. Is it fine? Any questions? So this is how I want you to start, you know, thinking when you're trying to solve a question. You tell me if there is another way to do it and how difficult will that way be. So Tejasvini, let's say if you want to do this question, okay. You have to take a lot of cases. Number one, let's say student number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. You have to start distributing the number of prizes in such a way that no number is 5 and their sum is 5. Are you getting my point? So you start breaking 5 as 4 such numbers, none of them being 5, such that they add up to give you a 5. Something like 0, 1, 2, 2, 0. Correct? That means student number, you have to break into 5. So you have 4 prizes, right? There are 4 prizes, right? So let's say student 1, student 2, student 3, student 4, student 5. Now see the complexity of the way if you want to do it in another way. let's say four prizes you're distributing. So let's say this guy gets zero, this guy gets one, this guy gets one, this guy gets two, this guy gets zero, right? Now here also you need to understand which of the four prizes this guy has got. So there is 4C1 way to choose this, right? Then there is 3C1 way to choose this. Then this is 2C2 ways to choose this. So this is one possibility. There could be so many other possibilities like 1, 1, 1, 0, 2. Sorry, there are only four prizes, right? This is also one. Okay. So there could be so many cases. So multiple cases will come up and you will, you know, go mad counting them. So that is the only smarter way to solve the problem. Other ways would be leading to complicated counting. Our purpose is not to complicate our counting. Our purpose is to simplify our counting. Okay. All right. So let's take more questions. Let's read the rest of this question. The number of ways in which five letters be mailed in three different mailboxes, if each letter can be mailed in any mailbox. Let's put the poll also on. Question understood. There are five letters and there are three mailboxes. Okay. How many ways can you post these letters in these three mailboxes? Okay, Shardali, Siddharth, good. You have given me a response personally also. That's good. No problem, Shardali. Setu, if you want to type your answer on the chat, you can go ahead. Most welcome to do that. I could see 14 of you have voted so far. I'll give 30 seconds more. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, now you can see in your poll result, I'm sharing this result with everybody. Now you can see equal number of votes have gone to B and D. You know why? Because people are confused whether the answer will be 3 to the power 5 or 5 to the power 3. And I know this confusion was evident. Okay. Again, this is where your basic, you know, breaking of the task comes into picture. So what is the task that you're doing here? Posting letters, correct? How many letters are there? Five letters, L1, L2, L3, L4, L5. Okay, so your task is to post letter number 1 and letter number 2 and letter number 3 and letter number 4 and letter number 5. How many ways can you post letter number 1? Write down on the chat box. Three ways, three mailboxes are there. How many ways can you post letter number two? That also three ways. Letter number three, that also three. That's also three. This also three. Okay. Oh, what happened to my three? three. Okay. So your task is to post all the letters. Letter L1 and L2 and L3 and L4 and L5. Right. So your task will not be completed till you post all the letters. So the answer to this by fundamental principle of multiplication will be 3 to the power 5. Option B is correct. Is it clear? Any questions? Now see, if you are going by, you know, counting which letters go into a mailbox, Tejaswini, it will become a tedious process of counting because all five letters can go into one mailbox. That doesn't mean you are, you know, putting all the, see, you can choose your letters. Which letter will go into which mailbox, right? So there would be a complicated distribution, just like the prizes and the students. Prizes are like, let's say, you know, you can, you know, relate it to any of the two. So which prize will go to which student? That also will become complicated. So instead, take the work as posting the letters, and each letter has five options to be posted. That would be a wiser way to solve the question or a smarter way to solve the question. Are you getting my point? 5 to the power 3 will not be the answer. The reason being, see, what are you trying to say? You're trying to say that a mailbox has got 5 options. Correct? It's not about 5 options there. A letter has got 3 options to fall in any of the letterbox. Because a mailbox doesn't know how many letters are going to fall and which letters are going to fall in that. But letters know that there are only 3 options for me. I can use any one of the option to get inside. Right? So please understand this. If you have not broken up your task wisely, you will end up getting wrong results. Okay. Now let me give you a synonymous question. Let us say in a lift. Okay. This is a lift. Okay, this lift is carrying 8 people. Okay, I'm just making 8 people in this lift. Big lift. Okay. Okay, so these are the lifts. Okay. This lift stops at 5 floors. So there are 5 floors in which this lift stops. Okay, floor 1, floor 2, floor 3, 4th floor and 5th floor. Okay. In how many ways can these 8 people alight or get down on these floors, given that any number of people can get down on a floor? So in how many ways can these, let me write down the question. In how many ways can the 8 people or can the 8 persons alight on these floors, on the 5 floors, these floors, where any number of people can get down on any floor? Again, I'm getting 2 answers, 8 to the power 5, 5 to the power 8. What is your task? Is your task to fill the floors or is your task to make the people get down? Ask your question. Ask that question to yourself. Was your task in the previous question to fill the mailboxes or to post the letters? Very deep question is this, okay? If you're not able to answer this, you'll not get a right answer. So what was your task in the previous problem? posting the letters or filling the mailboxes? Posting the letters. What is your task here? Making the people get down or make, or, you know, filling the floors with people? Making the people get down, right? So if you're making the people get down, person number P1 should also get down. P2 should also get down. P3 should also get down. Till P8 should also get down. Correct? So now you are providing options to these people. So person number one, how many options you have to get down? He will say, I have 5 options to get down. Person number two, you're asking him, how many options you have to get down? He'll say, I also have 5 options to get down. 5, 5, 5. What will you add? What will you do to these 5, 5, 5s? Will you add them or will you multiply them? Add them or multiply them? Multiply them. Because all the people should get down in order to accomplish the task. The answer to this question is 5 to the power 8, not 8 to the power 5. Understood? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Let's take more interesting questions. I mean, I can keep on giving you more questions. So let's say there is a room. Okay. This room has got 10 light bulbs in it. Okay. So there are 10 light bulbs. Okay. Of course, I'm not going to make all the bulbs. Dot, dot, dot. Okay. There are 10 light bulbs in this room. Okay. And these bulbs are operated by independent switches. Okay. So this is a switch for each of these bulbs. Okay. Switch 1, switch 2, switch 3, da, 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 switch 10. Okay. This is bulb 1, bulb 2, bulb 3, da, 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 till bulb 10. Okay. My question to you is, in how many ways can the room be lightened up? In how many ways can the room be lightened? Lightened means there should be light in that room. Okay. Okay. Shardili, very good. Nikhil, very good. Anybody else? Only 2 people effectively have answered this question. What about others? Okay, Vaishnav. Okay, Karthik. So Karthik, if you light 2 bulbs, will the room be not lightened? If you light 3 bulbs, will not be room lightened? You further reduced your answer. Okay. Now I'm getting varieties of answers, right? From 10 factorial, 100, 1, 90. Of course, there are some right answers also in this. I will not tell them actually. Now, most of you are just trying to force fit factorial, right? Just because you have learned factorial, you let's use it. No. Okay. So see, understand here. Logically, when will the room be lightened? When at least one bulb is lightened. It doesn't matter how many. But at least one bulb should be lightened. Correct? Now, if I ask you this question, how many ways can you operate on these switches? What is the total number of ways you can operate on these switches? Now, remember, a switch has got only 2 states, on or off. Correct? So, let's say I write down the options that I have for all my switches. Okay. So every switch has got two options, whether to be on or whether to be off. Correct? Right? So you can on the switch one or off the switch one. Switch two also on, off. Switch three also on or off. On or off. On. It can't have both the states together. It can only be in one of the states. Okay. So altogether, how many states you can provide to these switches? And you have to provide one of the states. Either it could be on or off. It cannot be in a third position, right? So altogether, you can provide 2 to the power 10 states to these switches. That means 1024, right? Now, in this 1024, there is one such case where everybody will be off, isn't it? And that's the only situation when the room will be dark. Remember, what did I say? At least one switch should be on for your room to be lighted up, isn't it? So there is one situation where the room will be completely dark when all the switches have been in the off position. That one is something which you need to exclude from your answer. So the room will remain dark. Room remains dark only in one way. Dark, sorry. I wrote a dark. Okay, and only one way. So this you exclude from here. So if you exclude that one way from here, 1023 ways, or 2 to the power 10 minus one way, is the ways in which the room can be lightened up. This is your answer to this question. People who are saying 100, people who are saying 10, people who are saying 1, or people who are saying 10 factorial. Basically, you had to use 10 somewhere. That is why you were giving those answers. Okay. So it does, when you are saying, so when you're saying you want to make the switch like room lightened up, you can switch on any number of combination of these switches, or any number of combination of these bulbs, right? So what I did first, I found out all possible ways I can switch on or switch off these bulbs. So that is 10, 2 to the power 10. And in that 2 to the power 10, there's only one way where all the switches will be off. Off everything, that's one way, right? That one you subtract. So when you subtract one, you are basically ensuring that at least one switch is on. And because of that, room will be lighted up. Same amount of, in how many ways will the room have the same amount of brightness? No. 10 will not be the way. See, same amount of brightness, you're talking about brightness of one bulb. So if there's a brightness of one bulb, there are 10 ways in which you can brighten up by one bulb. If you want a brightness of two bulbs, right? Normally brightness is measured in terms of lumens, or in TV we call it as nits. Okay. So two bulb brightness, you can choose 45 ways to do it, 10C2. Any two bulb you pick up and on it. Okay. Three bulb brightness, 10C3. Okay. Are you getting my point? So that answer will be something else. Okay. That answer will become something else. Okay. So basically, no, identity will matter, no, because every person is a different person. Let's say out of those 8 people, no, person number 1 getting on floor number 2 and person number 5 getting on floor number 2 will be counted as a different combination, right? People are all distinct, no, they have an identity. Okay, so I have a question for you all here. Let's take this question and then we'll take a break after this. The number of ordered pairs m comma n, where m and n come from this set of 1 to 50, such that 6 to the power m plus 9 to the power n is a multiple of 5. And again, I'm putting a poll on for you all here. I'll give you sufficient amount of time to work this out. Okay. I think 2.5-3 minutes is good enough. Yeah. Oh, I think one of you was in a rush to answer this. So I've only got one response in almost 11 seconds. And that is wrong, by the way. yes, Tejaswini. M and N can be same numbers also, right? Last minute, I could just get two responses so far. Okay, countdown begins. 5, 4, 3, 2. Okay, two. 2 minutes more I cannot give, because see, the lifespan of a question is only 4 minutes. See, to understand this. And we need to keep in our practice also. If time is not considered, then JE advanced paper is also easy, right? Give me 1 month, I will solve JE advanced paper. Okay? It's not 1 month. You have to do it in 3 hours, right? If you remove the time factor from a question, then the question is a dead question. I can give 1 more minute if you want. Okay, Shardali. I can see a very mixed response coming from the crowd. All the options have been touched upon. Okay, so let's discuss it. I'll close the poll now. Okay, anybody wants to vote? Take a guess if you couldn't solve it. Take a guess. Take an intelligent guess. When I say take guess, people normally go for B option, but don't do that here. Choosing B would be hazardous. Okay. Great. Now, Most of you have gone with C, by the way. C is the most chosen option. Let's discuss it out. See, when you talk about, just give me a second. Yeah. So when you talk about this type of term, 6 to the power m, okay, and 9 to the power n, okay. Now see here, if you want to find out how many, you know, numbers or how many combination of m and n are possible, for which this is a multiple of 5, okay. A multiple of 5 has a very important characteristic which you everybody knows here, that it should end with a 5 or end with a 0, correct? So any multiple of 5, okay, it should either end with a 0 or end with a 5, correct? Yes or no? Now, if I raise any natural number power to 6, not only limited to 1 to 50, any number you raise, this will always end with a 6 or end in a 6. Isn't it? 6 to the power 1 ends with a 6. 6 to the power 2, 36 ends with a 6. 6 to the power 3, 216 ends with a 6. Okay. And any multiple of 9 either ends, let me write with only because I have used with. Ends in and with both are fine, no issues. Let's not worry about the English involved in. 9 to the power n, and of course n could be any natural number, could either end with a 1 or end with a 9 itself. Correct? 9 to the power 1 ends with 9. 9 to the power 2 ends with 1. 9 to the power 3 again ends with 9. 9 to the power 4 again ends with 1. So either it'll end with 1 or end with 9. Okay. Now, in order to know whether the sum of this number, okay, what will it end with? It will either end with a 7, right? Or it will end with 5, because 9 and 6 will add up. This will end with a 5. Correct. And this will end with a 7. Right? Now I want those cases where they end with a 5, because only the ones which end with a 5 will be multiple of 5. This is ruled out. This is one. This is the one which we desire. Correct? Now, in order to end with a 5, is there any restriction on m value? Because you can't place any restriction, because any number you choose from 1 to 50, it will end with a 6 only. So there are 50 ways to choose M. Correct? But for 9 to the power N to end with a 9, you can only put N value as 1, 3, 5. That is nothing but, yes, all the odd numbers you can put. So there are only 25 ways to choose your N. Right? So there's no restriction on M. You can choose any number from 1 to 50. That is fine. So 50 ways to choose your M. But 9 to the power N, if you want to end it with a 9, and hence the sum should be a multiple of 5, you only have 25 ways to choose your N. That is all the odd powers from 1 to 50. So your task was what? Your task was choosing your M and N both. This and this both. So this you can choose in 50 ways. This you can choose in 25 ways. And means multiplication. Answer is 1250 ways. Right? So option number A was correct. Let me see the poll result. Only 4 people got this right as per the poll result. Out of 30. Is it clear? Any questions, any concerns, please highlight. Okay, Setu, no issues. Fine. Here we'll go for a break. Okay, the time as per my watch is 6:13. I will see you at 6:28 p.m. exactly after 15 minutes break. eat something, rejuvenate yourself, and we'll meet in 15 minutes time. Okay. See you on the other side of the break. Now I'm going to start with your understanding of the permutations concept. Okay. So officially the first topic that we are supposed to talk about in this chapter now has begun after so much of groundwork being done, especially knowing your fundamental principles of counting. Because without them, you will not be able to understand what's permutation, what's combination, and how to accomplish these countings. Okay. So as I've already discussed with you, permutation basically means arrangement, and arrangement means you're not only selecting items that you want to arrange, but you also are, you know, giving some order to them. Okay. So here, the very first thing that you would come across is the constant use of this symbol NPR. I'm sure many of you would have already seen it in school. By the way, in some books, they will write it as P with, argument of N and R, right? Basically, they want to give it as a look of a function, just like a function has got, you know, some kind of inputs. So here P is a function, which, you know, obviously manipulates or works on these inputs and gives you some result, right? So NPR is basically nothing but, let's find out the way to read this formula also, or this symbol also. NPR, wherever you see, it's basically a symbol to say number of ways to arrange R objects taken from N distinct objects. Are you getting my point? So this word distinct is very important. So if the objects, these N objects, are not distinct, that means if some of the objects are identical, you cannot use NPR, or this symbol will not be utilized in solving that kind of a question. So if at all you are using, or you're trying to, you know, give an answer to that question, or if at all you're reading that there is an NPR, the first thought that should come to your mind is NPR means number of ways to arrange R objects. Okay. Of course, your R has to be less than equal to N. So number of ways to arrange R objects taken from N distinct objects. Are you getting my point? This is very important. So for example, if I say how many ways can you arrange two objects taken from three objects, you will say 3P2, but only when these three objects are distinct objects. That means they should not be identical. So A, B, C, if you have three distinct objects, how many ways can you take two objects and start arranging them or ordering them? So you can do it in the following 3P2 ways. Okay. We'll come to that final value of it, but this is how, what 3P2 value will be. In this case, it will be AB, BA, AC, CA.
I'm sorry.
Then BC, CB. Okay. Later on, we'll learn how 3P2 value is actually 6. Is it clear? If your any two objects were identical, let us say it was AAB. And I said, take two objects and arrange them. Now remember here, if you take A and A, there's no point writing it again A and A. Both will be counted as the same. So either you have AA, either you have AB, or you have BA. So there are only three ways to do this. Okay. So this is not 3P2. This is not 3P2. This is 3P2. So 6 is your 3P2. Okay. Understand this. Very, very important. Now, symbol you have understood. You have learned the meaning of this symbol. Now let us derive the result for the symbol. What is this expression equal to? So in terms of N and R, or in terms of factorial, etc., whatever you will be, you know, coming across in some time, what is NPR equal to? What will NPR give us? Okay. So we'll start from scratch. We'll start from fundamental principle to derive NPR. So NPR is what? Number of ways of arranging R objects taken from N objects. Correct. So think as if there are N students. By the way, students are identical, or students are distinct objects. Every person is distinct, isn't it? Right? Each student is different from the other, right? Yes. Now let's say there are n students and there are r chairs. Okay? There are r chairs. Okay? So there are r chairs. You want to arrange r students taken from n students over these r chairs. So you're making a linear or a row wise permutation of r students taken from n students. How will I do this question? How will I accomplish this task? Now, one way is you choose them and then you order them. But again, choosing something is not something which we have done. We'll do it later on. Combination is what we are going to take up later on. So let's say, irrespective of whether you know or you don't know, how will you start filling up these places? How will you start filling up these chairs? Let's try to answer it. First chair, how many options you have to make a person seated on a first chair? Or how many contestants do you have for the first chair? R contestant. N people are there, no, in front of you, Karthik. You have N people contestant, right? Any one of them is eligible to sit on this chair, right? Okay, great. How many contestants or how many people are eligible or how many options you have to fill up the second chair? N minus one, because one person has already been seated on first chair. Okay. How many options you have for the third chair? You'll say N minus two. Fourth chair, you'll say N minus three. Okay, now think carefully and answer. How many options you have to fill the Rth chair? Okay, Nikhil, correct. Setu, Tejaswini, correct. Okay, so yeah. All of you have given the right answer. So it's N minus R plus one. Okay. Karthik, both Karthiks. See, first chair and see the pattern, Karthik. First chair N minus zero is, that's N actually, right? Second chair N minus one. Okay. So whatever is this number, subtract one less than that number from N. That is your answer. So it's actually N minus R minus one, which I have expanded to N minus R plus one. That's why I said think and answer. Anyways, now as per fundamental principle of counting, will you add them or will you multiply them? Will you multiply? You'll multiply them, exactly, because you have to fill the first chair and the second chair and the third chair and the fourth chair and so on till the nth chair. So as per fundamental principle of counting, you will multiply these results. And there you go. This expression is your formula for NPR. Got it? Any questions, any concerns? Now, many people say, sir, but our teacher told us in terms of factorial, etc. No problem. We will simplify this in terms of factorial. Repeat what part, Manu? The whole thing, the whole process? See, we are trying to find out what is NPR expression, right? NPR expression is number of ways to arrange R people chosen from N people in a row wise or in a, on, let's say, a chair. Okay. So I've taken a case study for this. Let's say there are N students and you have R chairs. How many ways can you, arrange R people on these R chairs taken from N people? So for that, I started the process by filling up each chair one by one. So first chair can be filled in N ways, right? Do you agree with me on that? Isn't it? So let's say there are 10 students. You have three chairs. So first chair, you can make any one of the 10 guys sit. Okay. So second chair, any one of the 9 guys sit. Third chair, any one of the 7 guys, 8 guys sit, correct? Same way I'm basically filling up these chairs. First chair, N ways. Second chair, N minus one way you can fill it. Third chair, N minus two, and so on and so forth. So Rth chair can be filled in N minus R plus one th way. Acha, let me give you a simpler number to understand. 10 people. Okay, first chair you can fill in how many ways? And we have 3 chairs. First chair, how many ways? 10 ways. Correct. Second chair, 9 way. Third chair, 8 way. Isn't this 8, 10 minus 3 plus 1? That's why n minus r plus. Clear now? Sir, if all the n students can sit in any one of the r chairs, won't the second and third, etc. also be nn? No. See, you are basically making people sit. Right? And once the first chair is occupied, it is occupied by some person, right? Remember flag question. Once a flag, first flag is chosen, you can't choose the same color for the second flag, no? Correct. So how can one person occupy two different chairs at the same time? Okay. Okay. Now, this expression that you have over here is a slightly complicated looking expression. So many a times in the books and in the school, they will simplify this expression. How do they simplify this expression? All of you see, I'll rewrite this expression once again. Okay. Let's say I multiply with the term which is coming exactly after n minus r plus 1, which is actually n minus r, and I also divide with this term. Will it change my expression? Does the original formula change by multiplying and dividing with n minus r? All right. Yes or no? Does this answer change by multiplying and dividing the expression by n minus r? No. Okay. Let's continue doing this activity. Let's now multiply and divide with n minus r minus 1, n minus r minus 2. And let's say I go all the way down to 1. This also all the way down to 1. Correct? Now, do you see that the numerator is actually a continued product from n till you reach 1? What is the continued product of n till 1 called in language of factorial? N factorial, right? What is the continued product from n minus r to 1 called? N minus r whole factorial, right? So this is an alternative and easier looking formula which you can keep in mind for remembering your NPR expression. So NPR is n factorial by n minus r factorial. Now remember a question I gave you a little while ago where you had to make arrangements of two letters chosen from ABC. So the answer was 3P2. So in expanded version, it is 3 factorial by 3 minus 2 factorial, which is 6 by 1, which is 6 ways. That's why the count came out to be 6. Is it clear? Any question, any concerns related to NPR here? Okay. Let's look into some properties of NPR. If this is done, we can move on to the next slide and we can look at the properties of NPR. Any question, any concerns, anybody, do let me know. So you can see this is not a rocket science formula. This formula was not given to us by any, you know, saint or any god. It came from a logical, you know, expression of fundamental principle of counting. Okay. So I have a snapshot of certain properties which I would like to, you know, take up one by one. Okay. By the way, you can just ignore this fourth one. I'm just scoring it off. Yeah. So let's talk about properties of NPR. Properties of NPR. Just to save time, I've taken a snapshot. Look at the first property. It says that if you want to arrange n different things taken all at a time, it will be NPN, which is actually correct. Because out of n things, if you take all the n things and start ordering them, or in short, you are arranging n things among themselves. Then the number of ways to do it as per the formula is NPN. And that comes out to be, from your formula perspective, N factorial by N minus N factorial, which is N factorial by 0 factorial, which is actually N factorial itself. Okay. So remember, what did I give you when I was talking about the definition of a factorial? Factorial represents the number of ways in which you can order that many substances which are distinct, first of all. That's why this word different becomes important. So N different things among themselves means taken all at a time. Okay. So formula also of NPN says it is going to give you N factorial only. Okay. Apart from this, there are some special values that you can keep in mind, like NP0 is 1. NP1 is actually N. Okay. Now, many people say, sir, how is NP0 1? Because if you read this, it basically sounds very weird to us. How many ways can you arrange R objects taken from N distinct objects? Doesn't it sound weird? It does, right? Yes or no? Okay. So when you say how many ways can you arrange 0 objects taken from N objects? So if you're not taking any object, how can an arrangement happen? Right? That thought comes to everybody's mind, isn't it? It came to me also when I was preparing for my competitive exam. But again, this is a mathematical inconsistency. And in order to solve this mathematical inconsistency, we basically rely on that formula or rely on this fact that there's only one way. That means nothing you can do. When you're not choosing anything, how can you arrange them? Right? So we call that only one way. Okay. So there's one way of choosing nothing and arranging them among themselves. Okay. You can't say 0 also, because that will create a mathematical inconsistency. That is why 1. Is this fine? Any questions? Okay. Now coming to the third, from third onwards, we should be slightly, serious in these properties, because they are very useful. If you see the third property, it says NPR can actually be broken down into N minus 1 PR minus 1. Okay. Now let us try to logically prove this. What is a logical proof for this? Can anybody logically prove this? Logically means with logic, not with formula. Formula, I know you can prove it very easily. Just like how you basically played with your fundamental principle of counting, can you basically prove this also? Just by logic. No formula, logic. Okay, let me give you a situation here. See, again, let us say there are R chairs. Okay. There are R chairs. And there are N students. I want to arrange R students taken from these N students over these R chairs. Or in short, I want to arrange R people taken from N people. Okay. So one way to do it is NPR. Correct? Another way to do it is, this is one way to do it. Another way to do it is, let's say I break this event like this. One of the students here, let me name somebody, maybe Setu. He says, sir, I'm feeling very hungry. I'll come back in 5 minutes. I'll have something from my school canteen and I'll come back in 5 minutes. Meanwhile, you arrange those, the remaining people on those chairs, right? So let's say Setu has left the scene. How many people are there in the crowd? How many people are there in the crowd? N minus 1. Oh, sorry. Let's make a different story, because I have a different thing to prove. Okay. Let me do it in this way. Now, let's say, I'm canceling it out, because, that is not applicable, because I did not see this part of the question. Yeah. See, let's say one chair is a special chair. Okay. Any chair you choose and call it as a special chair. Let's say this chair is a special chair. You can say the Maharaja chair. Okay. Now this chair I want to fill first, because that is a special chair, a chair of authority, and I want to fill that chair first. How many ways are there to fill this chair? N ways, correct? So I fill this chair first, and means multiplication as per fundamental principle of counting. And I then fill the remaining R minus one chair from people chosen from N minus one left off people, because one person has already come and sat on this chair, correct? So remaining N minus one people are, you know, still there to be chosen from. And I have to fill the remaining R minus one chairs from those N minus one people, correct? So that task can be done in N minus one PR minus one. So eventually what am I doing? I'm filling all the R chairs from people taken from N people, isn't it? Whether I do it by this method or whether I break the task like this and do it, eventually both the countings are going to be equal. That means your NPR and N into N minus one PR minus one would be equal. Correct? Yes or no? See, why I'm giving a logical proof is because it will, you know, start making you think how to solve a problem in permutation combination. If you start thinking like this, then you will feel that this chapter is very easy, right? You can work your way out in any difficult situation. Else you'll always start thinking in terms of some formulae, which is not going to help you out in the longer run. Okay. Now, if you see, the formula also says N into N minus one into N minus two PR minus two. Can you prove that also in a similar way? Exactly. That's what has been done, Karthik, here. Now here, you could also do this work in another way. You can say, okay, let two chairs be special chairs now. Right, exactly, Tejaswini. Very good. So let two chairs be special chair. So let me fill special chair number one first, and then I'll put special special chair number two. So one can be filled in N ways, two can be filled in N minus one way. The remaining R minus two chair has to be filled from people taken from N minus two left off people. So this is chair number one, special chair number two, and the remaining chairs, sorry, N minus two PR minus two. Okay. So your task can also be done by, you know, doing this multiplication. So this will also give you the same answer, and you can continue, you know, proceeding on and on till you basically have exhausted all the number. That means all your chairs have become your special chairs now. Okay. So this is how I would like you to start thinking, or at least inculcate that thought process slowly and slowly as you are learning this chapter. Okay. Now, many people ask me, sir, these properties that you have written, that is number third property, or, you know, the properties which are going to come henceforth, do we need to remember those properties? No. Don't remember it. Understand it. Right? Let's do the fifth one. Why I scored off the fourth one is because fifth and fourth are actually the same properties. Okay. Yes. Fifth one. Fifth one says that NPR can actually be written as N minus R plus one into NPR minus one. Well, what is the logical proof for this? What is the logical proof? Can somebody give me a story and convince me that, sir, see, if you want to arrange R people, you want to take R people from N people and arrange them on R chairs, it is the same way as doing this activity or doing this, you can say, operation. Very simple. This is actually the reverse of what we did to prove the previous one. Hint. Who will tell me? take n chairs, chair bada diya aapne, okay, then at the rth chair it will be, okay, take r chair, rth chair will be n minus r plus 1, so remaining chair, why n minus r plus 1? See, now get this right, Asetu, don't get confused. You are trying to mix the previous proof with this. Sorry, the derivation of NPR with this. See, again, let's say there are R chairs. Okay. And one chair is a special chair. But this special chair you want to fill at the last. Okay. We'll fill this at the last. So first what I'm doing, I'm filling the remaining R minus 1 chairs. Right, so number of people in the crowd is still n, and I have to arrange r minus 1 people taken from those n people and put them on the chairs. Correct. Now, once all these chairs are occupied, I have to fill the special chairs. So that is the last thing that I'm going to fill up. Now, tell me how many people are waiting in the crowd after r minus 1 people have sat? How many people left? Tell me. Right. N minus R minus 1 people are left. So that many options you have for the special chair. So this into this is as good as NPR. Done. This is the proof. If you take R chairs, remove one of the chair, then the chair left is R minus 1. So the number of people required to fill the rest of the chair is N minus R plus 1. I didn't get that, Karthik. If you remove one chair, there is R minus 1 chair. Okay. And you want to arrange R minus 1 people on those chairs chosen from N people. So that's NP R minus 1. But that doesn't match with NPR, right? Because NPR is arranging R people from N people. But you only arrange R minus 1. How will that both match? That one chair you have removed that you are talking about. Oh, that is what I did, no? Indirectly, that is what I did here also. Correct? How is N minus, Setu, see here. N people were already there. You filled the yellow ticked mark chairs. How many people have already sat on the chair now? This many people have sat. This chair is vacant as of now. Correct. So this many people are left to be seated. No. Tejaswini. No. I mean, don't ask the silly questions here, at least basic questions. Are R minus 1 people are gone. They are seated on the chair. How many remain? N minus R minus 1. What is there to ask there? Okay. Is it fine? Okay. Now, I'll basically, it's not end of the properties. I'll give you some problematic statements. Okay. And then I'll ask you to, you know, get to those results. Okay, yeah, let's take this. Okay, now this is a property, but I have written it in a form of a question. Okay, question is, prove that number of permutation of n different things taken are at a time when a particular thing is always included in each arrangement is given by r into n minus 1 pr minus 1. Read the question. The question is basically having a restriction into it. Restriction is there is one particular thing which is always a part of your arrangement. So prove that the number of arrangements possible is R into N minus 1 PR minus 1. Again, logically think this out. You will be able to get your answer. Okay. So in order to prove this, again, I will use a logic. See, there is a particular thing which is always to be there. Now, this thing is already given to me that, okay, so this is the thing which you always have to put in your arrangement. So what I'm going to do, this N thing, I'm going to break up as, let's say I take it as a situation of students. Let's say there are N students and there is one special student there. Okay, let's say that special student is Mr. A. Okay. Now, out of those N students, there is one student which is special called Mr. A. A could be any name, by the way. And there are N minus one other students. Okay. Now, I have to make an arrangement of R students taken from those N students where Mr. A must definitely be there. So let's say I want to arrange them on these R chairs. And Mr. A has to be there in this arrangement. Okay, he's a special guy. He's, let's say, a special person. He has to be there. So what do I do here? I ask Mr. A, hey, go and pick up a chair where you want to sit. Because you're definitely there in the arrangement. So tell me how many options will Mr. A have to choose a chair? Right, Tejasini? Right, Karthik. So A can choose a chair. So A can choose a chair in our ways. Okay, in our ways. So he's that, you know, special guy, VIP treatment is given to him, right? So he say, oh, go boss and choose your chair where you want to sit. You are the VIP person. So this fellow goes inside and he basically takes, you know, careful observation and he picks up one chair and goes and sits over. So he has got R options to choose from. And the remaining N minus one people have to be arranged in how many chairs remaining? So one chair has already been occupied by A. So R minus one more chair remain. And N minus one people are there. So these N minus one people. So R minus one people taken from N minus one people or students can be arranged in. Can be arranged in N minus one PR minus one way. Now, will your task be complete? Will your task of arranging R people on these N chair, on these chairs will be complete if you just do one of them? No, right? You have to do both of them. So Mr. A also has to be selected and you have to ensure that R people are also seated, including Mr. A. So by fundamental principle of counting, you will multiply R with N minus 1 PR minus 1. So this is the number of ways in which you can accomplish this task where that particular thing is always included in your arrangement. Now here many people say, sir, don't we have to choose that particular thing? No. The word particular means that the thing has already been chosen. You don't have to apply any kind of a choices on that. So if you see the word particular, if you see the words specific, that means that object is already chosen and given to you. You don't have to apply an extra, you know, accounting there to choose that particular thing. Are you getting my point? Be very, very particular about this word particular, right? Because it appears in your questions and many people misinterpret it and get a wrong result. Yeah, Karthik, kind of a minister's, let's say some minister's son. So he is given some special preference. So he is the one who is the first one to occupy the chair. Right? You can think like that. Is it fine? Any questions here? Okay. Let's take another situation. See, I'm just exposing you to many situations. I mean, my purpose is not to, make you mug up any set of formulae. Okay. If you are learning enough to think like that, you can tackle any question that comes your way in this chapter. Okay. Let's take this question. Number of permutations of n different things taken R at a time when a particular thing is never taken into the arrangement. Now, this is even simpler. You'll say, Mr. A is never taken. So since he's a minister's son, okay, we will never entertain him. Okay, maybe because he's not eligible to be a part of the team. Okay, so here what will you do? You have effectively n minus one people to choose from because one person has been ignored because he is to be never taken into arrangement. So you have to complete a selection on arrangement of R people. You have to do an arrangement of R. So these R will be basically taken from these n minus one people and arranged. So that will be n minus one PR. Does it even need any kind of a writing from my side? Understood whatever I said? Do I need to write down something to tell you? Or understood? Understood? Okay. Great. Let me take you to another situation. Okay, let's do this one. Prove that the number of permutations of n different things taken all at a time when n specified things, now see the word specified is very important, they always come together. Okay, so there are n specified things which are always kept together in that arrangement. So how many ways can you do it? That result is given to you by this expression, m factorial into n minus m plus 1 factorial. Can somebody tell me how does that result come? Anybody? Shardali has figured out the way to do it. Okay, Shardali, can you explain how does it work? How do you get this m factorial and how did this m minus n? Yeah, why not? Please unmute yourself. Anybody can unmute and talk, please. Yes.
Hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Shardali, very much.
So they said m specified things should come together all the time. So if you draw n things.
Okay.
And if you want m things to come together, then you can place those m things in n minus m plus one ways, because if it's m from the beginning and they're totally n different things, then it's n minus m plus one from the end. So you can have m different sets like that in the whole arrangement. And if you have m sets like, sorry, you can have n minus m plus one sets like that in the whole arrangement. And then those m things can be arranged in m factorial ways amongst themselves. So it becomes m factorial into n minus m plus one factorial.
Absolutely right. Now see, whatever she has said, I will also explain it to everybody. See, what I normally do, I use a method which I call as the string method. Just to give, fine tuning to the method that Shardali has discussed. So I normally use something called string method. What is the string method? So those M specified things which we are keeping together, I tie them with a string. Let us say those M specified things are O1 till OM. So what do? I take a string and I tie them like this. How you bundle up, objects, right? So the reason I've tied them is just to show you that they become one single unit for you. Okay. So wherever they will go as a unit. So that they are always together in the arrangement, right? Isn't it? So it's like, let's say you have 10 books and 3 books you want to keep always together. What do you do? You bundle up those 3 books. Now, wherever you take, however you arrange those books, those 3 will always be together, isn't it? Now, what Shardali is saying that if let's say this is one, object, let's say one unit, and these are the remaining n minus m units, then total number of entities or the total number of units that you will have over here is n minus m plus 1 units, isn't it? So these will be the total number of entities. So one bundled one and the remaining n minus 1 together will be 1 plus n minus 1, which is this. Now, how many ways can you arrange these objects taken all at a time? What will you say? How many ways, number of ways to arrange n minus m plus 1 distinct objects among themselves. So they're all distinct, by the way, even though they're all bundled up, that bundled up is counted as one object. So how many ways can you arrange these n minus 1 distinct objects among themselves? You will say, sir, it is n minus m plus 1 factorial, right? Anybody has any doubt with this? Anybody has any doubt with this? Okay. And these m objects that you have tied with a string, the number of ways to arrange these m distinct objects among themselves. See, they can be intra-arrangement also, right? So these m objects, see, they're together. That doesn't mean it is always going to be in this order only, O1, O2, O3 till OM. No. OM can be the first one also. O3 can be the second one also, right? So you can do an intra shuffling of O1 till OM. And that can be done in m factorial ways, correct? So what you have to do, you have to arrange those objects, keeping those m objects together. So fundamental principle of counting says both of them have to be performed. So as per your fundamental principle of counting, your answer will become this into m factorial. Write it before or write it after. That doesn't make any difference. Is it clear? Any questions? Let's take a small instance or question based on this concept. Let us say, there are 10 friends. Okay. There are 10 friends. 5 of them are boys and 5 of them are girls. Okay. Okay. So let's say in a classroom, there are 5 girls, 5 boys. They're all friends. They want to go and go for a movie together. Let's say the class is going for a movie together. Okay. Now, in how many ways can these 10 students be seated in a row such that all the girls are seated together? So how many ways these 5 boys and 5 girls can be arranged in a row such that all the girls are seated together? Let me write it down. Find the number of ways to arrange 5 boys and 5 girls in a row. Sorry. Such that all the girls are seated together. One thing I would like to all tell you, don't give your answer in a calculated manner. Give it in a very raw format so that I can understand the logic behind it. Karthik, good. Good. Karthik has directly used the formula. Very good. Manu, okay. Siddharth, good. Anybody else? Okay, Tejasini, very good. Okay. Now, if this formula, remember, well and good, but I would never encourage you to remember this formula. Try to solve this question from the basics. So what I will do, see, 5 boys are there and 5 girls are there. Okay. So what do? I take a string and I basically tie them up and treat them as a single person. That's it. So all the 5 girls are treated as a single unit. So wherever they will move as a single unit so that they are together. So overall, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 entities or 6 units. So that can be arranged in 6 factorial way. But this doesn't account for the fact that the girls can be together even while they are shuffled among themselves. So it is not necessary that your girls row should start with G1 only. Right? It could be like G2, G3, G1, G5, G4. So there could be again 5 factorial intra-arrangement of the girls. Correct? That's it. Answer is 6 factorial to 5 factorial. Absolutely. Why, Shardali, that extra 5 factorial? Oh, sorry. It was a mistake. Okay. Yeah. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Now, one more thing I would like to discuss here is this property. Number of permutations, or you can treat this like a question, prove that the number of permutations of n different things taken all at a time when m specified things never come together. So now again, read it in light of the question which I gave you. Five boys and five girls are to be arranged in a row such that the girls should never come together. That means there should be at least one girl who is away from the group, sitting somewhere else. Okay. That means all the five should not come together. How many ways can you do it? Now, if you look at the answer that they have asked you to prove, it basically makes everything clear. You will say, sir, first of all, n factorial is the number of ways to arrange them without any kind of a restriction put into place. So this term is when there is no restriction. Okay. That means 10 people you are arranging on a row, you can arrange it in 10 factorial way. And this was your previous answer, right? This was your previous result. So you'll say subtract the previous result where your m of them are sitting together or m of checks are together. So when you subtract this result and this result, that means if you do n factorial minus m factorial times this, you will end up getting such cases where all the five will not be together. That means at the max four will be together. The one person will always be away. Yes or no? Yes or no? Any questions? Okay. Now let me give you a question. Let's say this time there are six boys and there are four girls. Okay. In how many ways can you arrange six boys and four girls? In how many ways can six boys and four girls be arranged in a row? Arranged in a row such that, or so that, no two girls sit together, or no two girls are together. Question is clear? Question is, you have to make these 10 people sit in a row such that there is no two girls sitting together. That means all girls have been separated out. Two ways. Karthik, somehow your answers are single digited answer, right? Doesn't it raise a concern in your mind that they might be wrong? Two ways. I can count 10 like that only. What two ways? The problem is you are taking away the identities from these people. Every boy, every girl is a unique one here. Right. So what you are seeing is the placements. Who is coming in those placements will change the number of ways, isn't it? Even if you take five girls, it will not be one, two way. Yeah. How will it be two way? Tell me, how will it be two way? Even if you take five girls, five boys, it will not be two way. It will be much more than that. Which girl's starts, won't it matter? What you're saying, I understood your concern. You're thinking boy, girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, starting with a boy. Or girl, boy, starting with a girl, right? No. Which boy starts, that is also going to make a difference. Oh, there are five boys. So how will it be two-way? It is not the gender of the person. It is gender as well as identity. Is it boy number one who is starting it? Boy number two starting, three starting. And then these five positions of the boys and these five positions of the girls, they're all changeable, right? If they change the combination, the arrangement will be a different one. Yes. Any idea? Okay, Pishim. Okay, Shahzuli, take your time. We have time. Don't worry. Absolutely right, Nikhil. Well done. Prisham has given an answer. Okay, Prisham, can you justify it? Why did you get 2 factorial into 9 factorial at the end? Acha, is the question that I'm talking about, is it same as the this concept which I discussed right now, or are they different? Is this concept and this question, are they different or are they same? That's what I asked. That's the reason I asked, are those two concepts same or different? If they're same, then your answer is probably right. But I don't think so, they are same. Right, they're different things. Okay. The reason why I gave this problem is because I wanted to see whether you are using the formula blindly, because that formula doesn't correspond to the situation. Read the question carefully and read the previous concept carefully. Previous concept says, those M specified things should not be together. That means M minus 1 can be together. M minus 2 can be together. M minus 3 can be together. But all of them should not be together. That is what this concept says. But what my question says is something else. Question says no two should be together. They are not the same things. Okay. Yeah, unless until you put a very special value of M, which is 2. Okay. Right, Setu? So let's say you want to solve this question from a layman's perspective. How will you solve it? That is what we are basically trying to encourage everybody to adopt. So see, here I will be using a method which I call as a gap method. Right, so you already heard from me string method. Okay, now gap method. Now see, how does it work? So what do you want to separate here? Girls, you want to separate, correct? So first you make the boys arrange, right? So there are 6 boys, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5, B6. Okay, how many ways, just answer this question, whatever I'm asking you. How many ways can you arrange the boys among themselves? What is the number of ways to arrange the boys among themselves? Just write it down on the chat box. 6 factorial, correct. Good. Okay. How many gaps are there between the boys? Count the number of X's and tell me how many gaps are there between the boys. 7 gaps, correct. Now, can I say if I place the girls in these gaps? Okay, and even I can arrange the girls among themselves, doesn't matter. Can I say the girls will automatically get separated? So let's say girl number 1 comes here, girl number 2 comes here, girl number 3 comes here, girl number 4 comes here. So automatically you will see that the girls have got separated. So the arrangement here would be like boy one sitting, then girl one sitting next to him, then boy two, boy three, then girl three, boy four, boy five, girl three. Sorry, this was girl two, girl three, boy six, girl four, like that. So if you place your girls in the gaps over here, and of course you arrange those girls also, you would realize that you have achieved the purpose of the question, that the girls are all separated out from each other. Now, these gaps that I have shown, they are imaginary gaps. That means there is no chair there. That means wherever you put the gap, you automatically put a chair for the girl to sit there. Okay, don't be thinking like there are already chairs in between them. No, they are imaginary gaps. That means there may not be a chair there, but you're thinking as if there is a chair lying there. So let's say girl one wants to sit here, put a chair there for her to sit. That's it. Okay. So now think as if there are seven gaps. You have to pick four gaps from there. And not only that, you have to arrange these gaps like arranging the girls. How many ways can you do that? So how many ways can you arrange four girls or four gaps? Let me call it gaps. Four gaps taken from seven gaps. Okay. Now these gaps are all distinct because in these gaps, you're going to place distinct objects. So the gaps automatically become distinct. So that will be 7P4. So the answer to this question as per fundamental principle of counting would be 6 × 7P4. I think the only one person who gave this answer correctly was Nikhil. Okay. Now there's another way to prove it, another way to solve it, but that would be quite lengthy, which is like exclusion case, where you want to take total cases and you want to remove from the total cases those cases where any two girl is together, any three girl is together, and all the four girls are together. But that would incorporate a bit of, you know, complexity while you are applying it. So this is the safest way to solve this question. So this becomes your answer. So remember, gap method, very, very important and, you know, interesting method. Okay. So what I have exposed you is to some basic restrictive permutations, and we'll take a few more questions. I think one more we can manage to take in the next 5 minutes. Could you go up for 1 second? Okay. How up? Is this fine? Good enough? Setu? Okay, great. So whatever we have done, we'll take some, I know, questions based on the same, and then we will call it as a day. Okay. Now, in how many ways can these alphabets A, B, C, D, E, F, G? Okay. How many ways can these seven alphabets be arranged such that beg or CAD pattern does not appear in that arrangement? Understood what is the question saying? See, the question is saying you arrange it in, you know, you can arrange it in so many ways, right? But your arrangement should not be such that you can see a beg word in that or a CAD word in that. For example, let's say you arrange it like this. Okay, let's say A, C, F, B, E, G, D. Now, this is not allowed. Why? Because you can see beg word over here, correct? Okay. So just like the way you know, sometimes Sudoku and all are there, no? You can find out a word there. Okay. So this should not be there. Okay. Similarly, there should not be a word like this. Let's say B, F, G, C, A, D, E. This also is not allowed because I can see a CAD word over here. So beg or CAD word should not appear in that pattern. And of course, obviously it should not have a word like beg, cad, let's say some beg, fac. What is left off? I think f is left off, right? This also should not be there because both beg and cad word can be seen. So either this or both of them, not allowed. So how many such permutations of these seven letters can be done such that in no permutation, you can see a beg word or a cad word or both? Of course, both and all, I need not speak out. It is very evident. Just erasing it because this is just to explain you. And give your answer in a raw format. I don't want you to give me as a simplified a number because then I cannot see the logic behind it. I'm interested in seeing the logic that you are using to solve it. Okay, Setu. It's definitely wrong. Very good, Nikhil. Nikhil, you could have written that as 5 factorial also, right? Yeah. So 4 factorial into 5 is 5 factorial. Excellent. Very good. Why is my Siri getting activated? Hey, Siri, can you solve the question which I gave on the board? Siri is not responding. Okay, guys, let's discuss this. Okay. Now, first of all, let me ask you. Oh, 30 seconds you want? Okay, I'll give you 30 seconds. See, your solving is more important, right? I'm a facilitator. Ultimately, you have to achieve, right? Okay. Karthik, very good. Siddharth Karthik. Sharduli. Excellent, excellent. Noel, I don't want the answer in that way. No, sorry. Give me the answer in a raw format. I want to see the logic behind it. Karthik, Sanoj, we'll discuss it. Okay, see, if I have to solve this question, what I will do first, I'll find out the number of total words. Okay, let us say you be the total number of words. What are the total words you can make by using these alphabets only? Please note that you can make 7 factorial words. Of course, I'm using all of them at a time and I cannot repeat them because there's only 1A, 1B, 1C. So that's the meaning of the question. How many ways can you arrange these all alphabets? Means all of them have to be used. And they cannot be repeated because they are all present 1111, times in that expression. Right? This is a total number of words. Now let's say X be the number of or X be the set of words where beg pattern appears. So let's say the words where beg pattern appear. Okay. Let's say Y be the number of words where cad pattern appears. Okay, cad pattern appears. Now, what do I have to find out? Let me call this as universal set. Number of elements in the universal set. That means total number of words. So I have to figure out in how many words the cat pattern or the beg pattern doesn't appear. In short, I am using my cardinal properties of sets. Correct? Now we all know that this is nx, ny minus nx intersection y. Correct? Okay. Let's try to fill in this. This is already 7 factorial. Very fine. I mean, no worries about it. Now, nx. Nx means how many words are there where beg pattern appears. Now, let's take this word beg and tie it with a string. Apart from this, we have, I think, A, C, D, and F. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 units are there, which you can arrange in 5 factorial ways. Correct? Now here, please understand, you cannot intra-arrange BEG, because if you do intra-arrangement of BEG, your beg pattern will disappear. Correct? So no intra-arrangement of BEG. So this is the total number of ways in which a beg pattern will appear in a particular word. So that you need to subtract. Same will go for CAD also. If you tie CAD, CAD, and make it as an entity, let's say I'll do that again here. So let's say CAD, I tie it up. And of course, other words are B, G, F. Anything I'm missing? A, B, C, D, E I'm missing. Yeah. So again, 5 entities, and you can arrange them in 5 factorial. Please do not intra-arrange CAD. Okay. Yes, sir. So now this is also 5 factorial. But remember, when you accounted for the words where beg pattern is appearing, or when you accounted for the number of words where cat pattern is appearing, in both of them, beg and cat, both of them can appear. So you have to remove them. That is what this formula says. Double counting would happen in this case, or double removal will happen in this case, isn't it? So I'll figure out how many of these words where beg and cat pattern both appear. So I will take 2 strings now. Okay. And of course, there is one single alphabet F. Oh, I'm so sorry. Yeah. One single alphabet F. So now these 3 words, the 3 units can be arranged within themselves in 3 factorial ways. So that was an overcount in NX and NY. So that you remove from here. In fact, you're blindly following the formula that you had learned in your sets. So this becomes your final answer, and that will come out to be 7 factorial minus 2 into 5 factorial plus 6. Okay, of course, please, you know, calculation is, you know, your domain. I am not going to do it, but this is the logic. This is the expression that you should get. What is 3P4, Karthik Sanoj? Is there something like 3P4? Can you choose 4 objects from 3 objects? Okay, anyways, thank you. I think one of you had a doubt. I think Tejaswini had sent me a doubt. So we'll take that up, Tejaswini. You can stay back. Rest can leave if you don't have any doubt. Thank you so much. Good night. Take care.